Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 15th meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2024. This morning we have apologies from Stephanie Callaghan, MSP. First, our first agenda item this morning, we're taking evidence from two panels of witnesses on the Scottish Languages Bill at Stage 1. And can I welcome our first panel and thank you very much for joining us. Can I ask by starting our start by asking our witnesses to introduce themselves and say which organisation they're representing. I'm going to go around my screen as I see you, and top left it's Donald. Thanks.
Thank you for being back. Donald MacLeod, Chief Officer for Education and Children's Services with Corlin Yellen Shear.
Thank you. And Joanna?
Martin Va, I'm Joanna Peterana. I'm Area Manager for the Outer Hebrides with Highlands and Islands Enterprise.
And finally, James.
Good morning, I'm James Wiley. I'm Corporate Director for Education, Leisure and Housing for Orkney Islands Council.
Right, thank you. If we can just get things a little bit louder in the committee room, that would be helpful. Thank you for participating today. And I would like to just put on record that we had invited Solace to attend on several occasions, but they were unable to do so. And following that, COSLA were invited to participate, but due to last-minute nature, they were unable to field a representative. So we're going to go straight to members' questions this morning, and members should be directing questions to a specific witness, if you don't mind, and anyone else that wishes to respond, can you please put an R in the chat bar? That would be helpful. And the clerks are monitoring that chat bar, and I'll do my best to bring you in when I can. So thank you very much. And can we move straight to members' questions then? And to kick us off this morning is Pam Duncan Glancy.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to our witnesses this morning. And thank you for the information you've shared with us in advance of today. My first question is quite a broad one, and it is, how will the bill support Gaelic and Scots in the medium and long term? And if I could ask Donald MacLeod first, please.
Yeah, thank you for your question. I think from the Coroner and Shear's perspective, that the bill is vitally important in protecting the medium and long term future of Gaelic language. We recognise that Gaelic language is a fundamental aspect of our education delivery and a cornerstone of our socio-economic position in the islands and our future. So Gaelic has for many, many years been important to us, and we want to see the bill be able to secure, as the question is asked, the medium to long-term future of the language. I think the provisions that are in the bill in terms of education are important in terms of that. And to some degree, we'd like to see them strengthened and looking at the position around rights to Gaelic medium education and the role of Gaelic learner education within that as well, in terms of strengthening that educational position. But also, for instance, within the legislation in terms of areas of linguistic significance being very important to us within the island communities, to be able to, and we'd like to see more strength in the bill around areas of linguistic significance to make sure that we are recognising the importance of the language in terms of the priorities that our communities have. And I think we've still got a work to do in terms of managing what our communities aspire to for the future of the language and the important role it plays in population retention and growth of our economy, in supporting young people to stay in their islands and to live, work, earn and learn in our communities. So in summing up, I think we recognise that the bill is hugely important in defining the role of language in the future of our island economy and our island communities.
Thank you, Donald MacLeod, for that. In your submission that you sent in, you said that education by itself will not guarantee the future of Gaelic, and that accordingly the main emphasis of the bill should be directed to reviving Gaelic in community settings. So you touched upon some of that there. Could you say a little bit more about what else you would expect to see in the bill in that regard?
Yeah, I think it's absolutely right in terms of what you pick out from our submission there. A lot of our emphasis has been on Gaelic within the education setting, and that is in and of itself important, but we are increasingly looking to use and support Gaelic beyond school and beyond the environment as a pathway through that 3 to 18 journey through school and onwards into further study and employment. But we'd like to see the bill be able to strengthen the role of all organisations within the communities, with charitable and community organisations, with employers within our communities, to make sure that there's a rounded approach to Gaelic as a holistic language, so that it's taken beyond a language of the classroom, taken beyond a language that's to do with qualifications and school alone, which are important of themselves, but becomes a really genuine economic and community asset, so that employers, so that community groups, so that individuals within our community see the value of it and wish to use it in everyday life and to protect it for the future. We've seen in some areas potentially decline in the community use of the language, and the bill gives us an opportunity to work with our communities, particularly through ELSs, to try and make sure that we are strategically trying to revive the day-to-day use of the language in our communities. And that's where I think we've got opportunity to use the bill and to strengthen the bill further, to make sure that it there are measures within there in terms of either plans or standards or duties that make sure that the language is expected and becomes a standard practice for use in our communities.
Thank you.
So James Wiley's keen to come in, if that's okay, Pam, before you move on.
Of course.
Yes, thanks very much. And I think just to support what Donald's just said there, I mean, from our perspective in Orkney, we do support the principles of the bill in many ways. As was highlighted within our return, the 2011 census highlights that Orkney returned a significant number of people who highlighted that they spoke Scots. Now, from our perspective, we see the bill as having the potential to provide protection to language in Scotland. And from an Orkney perspective, as Donald has highlighted, the culture and heritage that goes with the language and the way in which we live and the history in which these islands have could well be protected in this if we get the detail correct. And we've highlighted that within our report, in our submission, highlighting that it's about language variation as opposed to dialect as well. So right across our archipelago, we have different aspects and use of words depending on which island you're in. And it's something that we need to ensure that we protect. It has a significant impact on our economy. It has a significant impact within the education and that whole pathway. But it's not just about the spoken word, it's about the whole culture that we engage in, our sport, our music, our arts. And so therefore, we do support the principle of what's within this bill as helping to protect the language.
Thank you, Pam.
Thank you very much, Convener. Thank you for that, both James and Donald. Joanna, just to Joanna Pietrana, to come to you. Picking up on the point that's just been made, actually, about the wider issues and culture and others, in your submission you say there are many wider contributing considerations in addition to Gaelic which are required for the communities and therefore the language to flourish, including factors such as housing, transport, connection, digital activity. And you then say acknowledgement of this in the bill would be welcome. So can I ask what you think the bill will do to support Gaelic, and what additional information you would, or additional provisions you would like to see in the bill to address the issues you highlighted?
Yes, thank you very much. And I would like to start by saying that I also echo much of what Donald and James have just said. I think key to the bill is that view that language does not exist in a vacuum and it should not exist purely in the classroom, as Donald touched upon, and that for it to thrive, it needs to thrive within communities, and for communities themselves to thrive, it requires all of that wider social and economic infrastructure. So I think if we could see something within the bill that recognises the requirement for that wider community infrastructure to exist in places, particularly with that opportunity to designate areas of linguistic significance, that opportunity to designate areas and focus upon those, and making sure that things like housing, digital, transport, connectivity are all in place to make those attractive places to live and work, that would be very much welcomed.
Thank you. I have one final question.
I think I need to move on, if that's okay.
That's fine.
Can we come to Ruth Maguire, please?
Thank you, Convener Mathenva, panel. Professor O'Gilligan described the situation of Gaelic and traditionally Gaelic-speaking communities as being in crisis. Can I first come to Joanna Peterana and ask how Highlands and Islands Enterprise would reflect on that comment, whether they agree and what the response would be?
Thank you. Yes, I think it's difficult to determine what is a crisis, but I do think reflecting as well, Donald touched upon this in his earlier words, that we have seen a decline in some places in the amount of Gaelic that is being used within communities. We're also seeing a lot of young people using Gaelic and going through Gaelic medium education, but then when they come out the other end of that, it's not translating into Gaelic being used within the home, within the workplace, etc. So without doubt, if Gaelic language is to continue to be a language that is alive and well in communities and is not just an academic language, then we do need to see much more use within community settings.
And in terms of the economic asset that Gaelic undoubtedly is, what work is Highlands and Islands Enterprise doing in that regard?
So we do a lot of work with businesses and communities within all the Gaelic-speaking areas where we encourage consideration of the use within the workplace. So we encourage employers to consider actively recruiting Gaelic speakers within their businesses. We also consider the opportunity for Gaelic to add some authenticity to the provenance of products and product offerings, so particularly within the cultural sector, but also within food and drink and within tourism, where that can add value because it highlights these products or services as being something from a particular place. And we know that that's very attractive to buyers and particularly for international buyers.
Okay, thank you. That's interesting. And can I ask Donald MacLeod, Coralyn and Ellen Shear's response to the statement that Gaelic's in crisis?
Yes, thank you. Similarly to what Joanna has described, crisis is maybe a more sensationalist use of language to describe the situation that we're in. I think we maybe need to be a bit more pragmatic in looking at the different aspects of data that we have, because in certain aspects of our own island community, Gaelic is still a strong language that is being used in everyday life. But what we are concerned about is what I mentioned in my previous response about aspects of seeing decline in the language, where we do have now a long-standing and stable Gaelic medium and Gaelic learner education system, but we don't have, I think, the stability on the future of the language in the community. So it's coming back a little bit to what James has said about needing to make sure that we have sports activities, cultural activities, music and events that and community aspects of community life that are conducted through the medium of Gaelic, and that we are constantly demonstrating the acceptable use and normalisation of the use of Gaelic as an everyday language in our communities. And I think we've sometimes encountered maybe degrees of concern about very correct and traditional use of the language and people being afraid or intimidated to use it. And language is constantly evolving. Gaelic is no different to any other language in terms of young people particularly and different generations of people using and evolving the nature of the language. And we have to accept that Gaelic should be the same way as that. And we shouldn't be discouraging people from maybe using evolved aspects of the language. But for me, I wouldn't go as far as to say we've got crisis in terms of what the professor has said. But I do think we have to take this opportunity that the bill presents just to make sure that we are arresting decline and are working strategically to make sure that we have a holistic community approach to making sure that the language is used and valued every day.
And so there's quite a distance between crisis and arresting decline. Is arresting decline urgent enough?
I suppose it's different in different communities within our islands. I can see there's merit in adding a sense of urgency to it. And that's why we particularly welcome the bill in terms of what it's aspiring to do. But I think sometimes labelling situations as a crisis can actually be unhelpful to moving on positively, because there's much good work going on, and it can be disillusioning to organisations working across the Gaelic community in their everyday work to feel like their work is not achieving what everyone was wanting it to achieve. And I think we need to kind of maybe take a more positive approach to it. And I Arresting Decline may be playing it down a little to a degree, but we do have good, strong work happening and want to build on that in a positive way rather than being critical of the decline.
And just finally, convener, if I may, and your local authority providing opportunities for children, young people, families, the whole community to take part in art, culture, sport through Gaelic?
Yes. Yeah, absolutely. And it's a key part of, as I said, recognising that we need to take the language beyond the classroom. We are trying to provide sort of formal opportunities, for instance, for parents and for community members to learn Gaelic, be that virtually or face-to-face. We're trying to support the greater use of Gaelic in community activity. We're looking at how we support youth and community to undertake sports and arts in Gaelic. We have rich participation in events such as the MODs, the Gaelic cultural and music events, Gaelic sports events, events like Film G, where we have high participation. But we also recognise that we have to move that beyond the individuals that participate in that to have a wider audience and try and make it into something that's more of everyday presence. We've got almost a two-stream element of it at the moment. We need to be very proactive in creating specific events that give the opportunity for a Gaelic immersive experience, but also trying to move it into a more accepted everyday language that'll be spoken in the shop or on the bus or down the street.
And sorry, I know I said finally there, but just one tiny final. Some of the things you spoke about there do tend to be geared towards the learner community, I guess. And within the Western Isles, you will hear Gaelic in the shops and while people are working and doing things. Are the two communities coming together? They're maybe not separate, but do you know what I mean? Is there a mixture?
I would say yes, but where it works best, it is where the communities come together. But I think it comes back to some degree to my earlier point about us needing to accept that, as with any language, everyone is in a spectrum of fluency. And we have to be more comfortable at encouraging the learner speaker to be confident at trying out the language and praising them and recognising having a go. And that's sometimes been a bit of an issue, depending on the kind of event that we're at. And the nature of how it's promoted, that we need to make sure it's as inclusive an experience as possible and is never discouraged.
Okay, thank you. That's helpful. Thanks.
I suppose, can I pick up on something? There was a lot of content there from yourself, Donald and Joanna, around about, taking the language beyond the classroom, Gaelic but it's not been translated to Gaelic being used in the home and the workplace. You want to talk about the normalisation of Gaelic in everyday communities to stop and arrest the decline, encourage people to try out the language at sporting events and become an accepted everyday language. That's just some of the things I've scribbled down. The bill doesn't help and make that any more possible, does it? Because you're already doing that. Donald, first, as you're on the screen.
Yeah, thank you. I think for me that this is where strengthening the face of the bill around areas of linguistic significance could be really important, alongside as I spoke about last week with the committee about how the standards are defined and how the measurements and the accountability that's there for authorities and other bodies that with responsibilities for Gaelic to move it beyond what's maybe there's degrees of strategic with it at the moment, but it can also be ad hoc. And if the areas of linguistic significance really have teeth and have a meaningful framework that will drive these improvements in a structured and strategic way, married with a robust plan and well-defined measures and accountability, I think we could see a more coordinated approach to that arresting of decline and fostering of growth in the use of the language.
I know I've got colleagues that are going to dig in and more around those areas of linguistic significance, but Joanna, do you have anything to comment on my question regarding the bill function?
Yes, well, firstly, just to say I completely agree with what Donald has just said there. I think that just to add something to that is that the power in designating an area of being of linguistic significance, I think also highlights maybe to members of communities that don't realise how important our places are in terms of the survival and the future thriving of a language. It highlights to them the role that maybe they play that they don't see. And I'm particularly thinking about some of the older members of the community with whom the language is really rich, and that we need to create that community confidence. And I think that's where a designation of that
we might need to get someone to check out your signal there. Joanna has gone a little bit awry. Can I move now to questions from Bill Kidd, please? Thanks.
Yes, thank you, convener, and thanks, panel. I think the first person maybe to come in on this, although it actually covers all three, I believe, James in Orkney, is the... Are you content with the approach the bill takes towards providing ministers with the range of powers to create duties on public bodies in relation to the delivery of Gaelic and Scots? James. He's speaking.
Thank you, sorry. From our perspective, we have concerns over the power, and from our position at the moment, we're slightly concerned about exactly what does that mean. And as we highlighted within our return from a local authority which has never had Gaelic as part of its culture, we fully accept that right across the vast majority of the rest of mainland Scotland, Gaelic was part of the culture. Our concern would be that it has never been in the Northern Isles. And what's been interesting is listening to the debate from the last three meetings of being assured that it would be in discussion with the local authorities. And we've already highlighted we would want that within our communities as well. But we still have concern that there's a lack of detail as to what that would actually mean and what enforcement would take place. From a Scots perspective, we're in a position where we have a concern over the bundling of the term Scots, and from an Orkney and probably from a Shetland perspective as well, we would be saying there's a language variant and not a dialect. Our language is based on very strong links with Faroese and Icelandic tradition. And so what we would be looking to see from this is a really clear acknowledgement of that clear language. And so from our perspective, we want to see more detail in this that links specifically to supporting our specific language, not just being lumped in with a wider concept.
Right. Well, thanks very much, James. I do understand what you're saying there, but I'm just wondering if you think that the bill as stands would actually create duties on public bodies to deliver, whether it is Gaelic or Scots, depending on which part of the country you're in?
I think it's getting there. I think it has to be very clear, though, as I said before in our introduction, that it's, from my own perspective, providing protection. So therefore, I do believe the bill is getting there. As I said, I just want to be absolutely clear that we're not going to be forced to do things that we shouldn't be doing as part of our culture. So, yeah, I would say it's getting to that point, yes.
Well, that's I'll come to that in a wee bit. But thanks very much for that. Joanna, do you have any thoughts on this?
Joanna?
Yeah, I think I missed part of the question due to my connection.
I'll just say again then. So just basically to ask what your opinion and is that on the approach the bill takes towards providing ministers with the range of powers which they might believe they need to create duties on public bodies in relation to the delivery of Gaelic and Scots?
Yeah, I think the bill does provide some good framework there, but my thinking is that it probably still needs to be strengthened in the detail around what those duties actually would be and how they would be monitored and what would be delivered as a result of conferring those duties upon bodies. I didn't think that was particularly clear so far, but we would certainly welcome that area being strengthened.
Thank you very much. And Donald, do you have something on this?
Thank you. Yes, as a local authority, we very much welcome the idea of duties being recognised within the bill. There were probably two points I would aim to make on it. First one being that I recognise that the bill itself, the face of the bill itself, may not define what these specific duties are, because there would be ability to maybe vary them over time. But I think that's where then the place of secondary legislation or statutory guidance would be really important in giving some definition to local authorities within consultation about what these duties may be, how they're fulfilled and how they're measured and what accountability is associated with them. The second point probably I would make in relation to that is a point I made last week to the committee was around trying, it's a diverse area of policy and how we marry the expectation of setting duties with local decision-making and local accountability recognised in the variation of both Gaelic and Scots across the nation, so that we somehow try to marry the imposing of duties with the ability to form and shape policy locally, reflecting local context. As we're seeing in the room today, the differences in language policy, say in the Western Isles or Orkney or Dumfries and Galloway or Aberdeenshire, could be very different.
Yeah, well, that's perfectly understandable. Thanks very much, all three of you, for that. And just on the back of that then, because this is a wee bit controversy maybe creeping in here, as has sort of been mentioned, where communities show little interest in Gaelic and Scots, should local authorities be able to not have to make provision in their own areas, do you believe? I think we're just going the same order again, James.
I think we have a responsibility in order to protect the languages. So I think that as a result, we need to be in a position where, in consultation with the Scottish Government, we should be working to see what's right for our communities. So from our perspective in Orkney, as far as I'm concerned, we would be, as a local authority, working to drive forward on having a plan for the development and the sustainability of the Orkney language. So, in answer to your question, I think there is a need for us in consultation to be driving that forward. And if we were not going to be doing it, there would have to be a very strong argument from a local authority in order to say why. But I should still think the local authority and the community in which it's operating in should have the right to be able to have that robust conversation with Scottish ministers. It shouldn't be an absolute enforcement. It should be a discussion and work our way through why and the purposes behind it.
Thanks very much for that. That's very interesting. Joanna, please.
Yes, thank you. I think what you said, I think that there should be no absence. It's the community that is making.
And I think, Joanna, I'm sorry, we are. This does.
My connection lost again.
Yeah, well, it's very intermittent, and I'm being kind, I think. Can we maybe get broadcasting to have a look at that? We might just have to go to audio only. But can we bring in, while that's while we're investigating that, Donald, perhaps?
Yep. Sorry, Donald, could you give us any idea what you think about this?
Yes, hopefully that's me unmuted. Yes, absolutely. It's an interesting question because, again, it comes round to this issue of the diversity of the use of language across the nation, both Gaelic and Scots in equal measure. As I mentioned earlier, ultimately would welcome the strengthening that the inclusion of duties would give to the Bill and the protection of languages. But and in context of our own authority, we would have no issue with that. But looking at it across the nation, there is a concern, and speaking with local authority colleagues from other areas, some concern about the potential risk of imposition of duties to provide provision for which there is no market. And it's coming back to the point I was making earlier around trying to marry the duties with mechanisms to have, as James has described, as a robust dialogue and degrees of local decision making. There is provision within existing legislation, as we've made aware, with communities being able to request Gaelic medium education, and we know that that's a bureaucratic and challenging process, and there's merit in that being able to be less bureaucratic and more streamlined. But there is, I think, a need to marry the wishes and aspirations of communities within a local authority area with the duty to make a provision to meet that need. So it's maybe a bit of supply and demand aspect to that for me.
Go back to Joanna, audio only. Let's hope that's a bit better. Oh, we've got an image. Right, let's see how we get on. Joanna.
Okay, I'll try again. I've switched my camera off now. Yes, I think critical in this is the community decision making. So I think it's important that it is the actual communities that get a voice in the decision about whether they are or are not an area of linguistic significance, and it shouldn't be purely down to any agency, whether that's a local authority or any other, to make that decision on behalf of the community. It must be based on robust community engagement.
Right. Thank you very much. I think that all three of you come back strongly speaking on behalf of the rights of communities, actually, over someone just making pure decision for them. So it was extremely interesting. I think there was a bit of unity in that. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Now, can we move to questions from Willie Rennie, please?
Okay, I'm struggling with what is this area of linguistic significance and what it's actually going to do. And I'm hoping Donald, when he was talking about the kind of secondary legislation, might fill in some of the gaps, is going to tell me that if I arrive in an area of linguistic significance, what I will see and feel and hear that's different, other than a sign on an entrance to a village. Can you tell me what's going to look like?
Yes, thank you. I think that actually is a concern that we have and has hopefully been echoed in our submission. We've got concerns and alluded to this that for instance, the National Gaelic Language Plan for 2023-28 talks of creating three Gaelic communities that are separate to areas of linguistic significance. And we don't completely understand how what's in the Gaelic National Gaelic Plan at the moment would relate to areas of linguistic significance. So our position on this really ultimately is recognising that there's huge potential within the bill for an area of linguistic significance being a major policy driver to make sure that there's accountability for local authorities, accountability for statutory bodies, for employers, for community groups, to have enforceable Gaelic plans that make sure that there's a strategic approach to development and growth of the language in the community. And that has to be linked, I think, then to standards and measures and accountability that will give the strength to that. But there are concerns that without that being defined, again, possibly not in the face of the bill, but certainly in secondary legislation, about the expectations of what an area of linguistic significance actually means, there is a worry that we have too, that it will become no more than a sign at the entrance to a village. And it has to become more than that. We also have concerns about how this may be potentially defined and what the criteria for identifying an area of linguistic significance may be. Reading through a number of the submissions to the consultation, there's a lot of talk about defining percentage per head of population of language speakers. That's a very narrow field, and I think we have to look at a suite of different measures and indicators that would highlight a potential area of linguistic significance. And we also don't want, say, for an area like the Western Isles, where Gaelic is spoken throughout the whole area of the local authority, we would be of a view of not wanting to set our communities against each other. I think we have to look at our whole island community as a potential area of linguistic significance, and don't want to rule out our more urban areas, such as the centre of Stornoway, where there are a large number of Gaelic speakers, but may not reach any threshold of percentage per head of population speakers. So we want it to be an inclusive approach that allows local authorities to be working very closely with their communities to determine that they want to become an area of linguistic significance, that they meet a set of criteria, and that there's some robust and enforceable plan around things happening in the community, which the community themselves should be contributing to and determining, and absolutely not being a sign at the entrance to a village.
So you've given me lots of stuff there, but you've not told me what it'll feel like. If you're in charge, in charge, but let's say that you're in charge of driving this policy and you're making suggestions to the community, what would you suggest that should be done?
I think that what you should see and feel is an absolute presence of the language in everyday life and in all aspects of what goes on in that community. That it is the first and foremost, it's in terms of Gaelic, obviously speaking from a Gaelic perspective, that it is a Gaelic first experience. That in every encounter that goes on, that in every asset or facet of life, that Gaelic is the first language of what happens there. That as a resident or visitor in that area, you can access Gaelic first resources, that that you have ability to access and learn language in that area, that there is coordinated approach to making sure that education is tied in with socioeconomic factors to make sure that there are employment pathways for people into roles in Gaelic, to make sure that the workforce is there with Gaelic speaking capability, that it's an authentic community.
So is there anything stopping you doing that now?
Ultimately not, probably ultimately resources, and that's another aspect of our concern in our representation, that an area of linguistic significance at the moment comes with no real tangible resource, particularly financially, with it. There are costs to creating that kind of environment and that kind of provision. And suppose there's the cost and resourcing element, and there's the consultation with communities element that hasn't happened yet. But although there's not really anything formally stopping any area doing this, the bill gives the opportunity to maybe not compel, but to strongly encourage communities to take this forward and to create communities that will strengthen the language.
With the convener's permission, if I could bring in Liam Kerr at this point, he might have a question on this.
Keen to respond to this James as well.
I'm very grateful. I'm very grateful to my colleague, Willie Rennie. Donald, on this exact point, given that the designation of an area of linguistic significance is the choice of the local authority, and as you've just acknowledged, if that choice is made, there will be a cost attached. So you talked about Gaelic resources, access and learning, education, employment pathways. You acknowledge the cost, and there'll be a cost to consultation. So given that local authorities are not awash with cash on any analysis, is it likely, in your view, that any local authority will choose to use the power?
I think that's a genuine concern. I think the financial memorandum recognises around about an estimated cost of, say, about £50,000 for an authority to go through that process. And maybe I'm not remembering the figures, I read it a wee while back, but there is an estimated cost that an authority may incur from their own resources to pursue consultation and establishment of an area of linguistic significance, and then also to meaningfully do something, as I've been discussing with Mr. Rennie there just now, will require financial resource. And absolutely, local authorities are in as challenging a financial position as they've ever been. Speaking from our own authority, we have a long-standing and deep commitment to protecting and developing Gaelic and Gaelic medium education and all aspects of Gaelic. So speaking from our own authority, it's something that we would strongly support, and we would want to find the resources to do that. But I think speaking and looking at other authority areas where the position on languages may be more marginal, I would tend to agree there's issues in incentivising the approach that would become difficult. But I don't think that's the position we as an authority would be in such a heartland area of the language.
Very grateful.
James?
You asked the question about what it would feel. So if you were arriving at the ferry terminal in the Orkney, you would be boarding a ferry that had a name that fitted with the language. The announcements on both the ferry services would be done in the Orkadian language. You would be hearing it. You would go off the ferry, and you highlighted that you were talking about it's not just the street names, but the street names would be in Orkadian or Orkadian dialect, or language. You have got that. The music, the sports and the arts, bringing people together through the abundance of festivals that go on in this local authority across the whole archipelago, bring together people who are using a language that all are hearing. And it's from my perspective, it's those points that are the most powerful. Because when you bring those communities together and the language has been spoken and people are hearing it, that's where words are starting to drip through the whole of our community. The school buildings where we are using at this moment in time language 3, so we are building the capacity in all of our children to understand Scots and to be using that. But go back to that point, you would hear it as a language for all, and you would be seeing it right across most things you're doing. Now, how does that fit into an area of linguistic significance? I would probably suggest that we're there. Would we be putting ourselves forward and spending all of that money? That would obviously be up to our elected members, but it's a lot of money for something that possibly is already here. What the bill does for us is try to protect that, to make sure that, and as Donald has quite rightly highlighted, when we get very clear criteria behind all of this, then that may well help to ensure that the sustainability of the languages across the country are supported in their development. But from an Orkney perspective, I would say we've probably already achieved some of that. However, come to Orkney and tell me whether we have.
You're very good at advert there. I'm quite keen to get myself up there very soon. Willie, carry on.
Joanna, do you want to come in? Yeah. Joanna, are you able to come in?
Yes, thank you. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Thank you for the opportunity to speak. I just to add to what's already been said, I think we also need to consider the fact that there's a potential cost to the economy of not doing some of the activities that we've just spoken about. We know, and I'll speak on behalf of Gaelic because it's what I know about, but I'm not discounting Scots from this, but I think that, you know, we're aware that Gaelic language adds to our economy through some of the things that I mentioned earlier, you know, the products, services, tourism, food and drink, etc., that use Gaelic as part of their business. And I think if we don't protect the language and don't take action to ensure that it's still a real live language within our communities, then some of that economic value could be lost. So it's not just the cost of putting in, I think we have to consider the opportunity cost of not taking action.
Okay, I think I'll just summarise by saying I think you've made quite a compelling case for what it could look like. But we've also, I think, acknowledged that it could happen already and that this bill really won't make that much of a difference in that regard, and finance is going to be a major hurdle for making this happen. So if this bill is going to be significant, it probably does need some degree of compulsion or requirement or standard around this, but I don't see that emerging from this bill. But anyway, convener.
Thanks, Willie Rennie. Ruth Maguire, you've got a wee sup in
here.
I do,
and I don't want to go over the top of Willie's summarising of the of the situation, but I do want to go backwards a little bit and ask, I suppose particularly Donald, I guess I'm more interested in what an area of linguistic significance would look like to somebody who lived there rather than me coming in as a visitor. And I wonder if, in terms of as a Gaelic speaker in one of your villages or in the town, would I be able to expect the right for my child to be able to do all the subjects in secondary school through the medium of Gaelic? Would my grandparent in a home have a care assistant who spoke Gaelic when caring for her? And I think some of these challenges, of course, the bill can't address in and itself, but I want to get a sense of how, A, do you think that sort of community, should the community be deciding rather than local authority? I think in your local authority, you have, as in the Heartlands, but there are other local authorities, perhaps Highlands and Islands, where it's a greater area. So should the community themselves be deciding? And as a resident of your area, what could I expect? And what's stopping those things happening now? Because I think there are perhaps challenges that are universal in terms of recruitment, housing, all these things that are faced in many rural areas.
We'll go to Donald first. Thanks, Donald. This does feel like them.
Sorry, muted. Yeah, apologies, it muted me again. Yeah, raised very interesting points there, and I think maybe some of our initial responses had been more about the sense of a visitor coming into that community. So I understand your perspective of wanting to explore what it should be as a resident. And for me, if an area of linguistic significance is going to be successful, I would absolutely agree wholeheartedly that it has to be in consultation with the community about what the community wants from that area of linguistic significance. If it is being able to have a full curriculum in secondary education, if it is about having a care home where everyone speaks Gaelic, if it is about having a cultural arts centre that fosters and develops the language, then that's what the plan, and I assume there would be a plan from an area, an implementation plan for an area of linguistic significance. It has to be in consultation with the community to define what should be in that plan. As much as it may be administered and overseen by a local authority, I don't think a local authority should be imposing on a community what the details and the actions of a plan for an area of linguistic significance should be. I think it has to be in consultation with what that community wants to have and what it maybe feels it's lacking at the moment or what it feels is its priority for strengthening and developing the language. So I would agree with that completely. And I would also maybe just take the opportunity to make the point as well that, as I mentioned, there would almost certainly be a plan from an area of linguistic significance to develop that, but that plan has to be realistically costed and resourced, and I think that is ultimately the concern. And I'm talking about the barriers to stopping these things happening now. I think there's the aspects of coordination and strategy, aspects of financial resource, and aspects of a lack of compulsion to do so. And I think that the bill, as much as there are issues around it, it could give the strength of creating some compulsion to make this happen. But I don't think it's quite there yet in terms of how we could do it, particularly around duties, measures, smart targets, resourcing, that would be supported. Because again, if it falls upon a local authority that hasn't got the resource to do it, it won't happen.
I think it's very helpful.
I suppose carrying on with that thread, though, I was wondering about how should our public bodies be held accountable for the support and services that they might provide in relation to the Gaelic language, and you spoke about care homes and art centres and things. And is the panel actually content with the proposals that are in the bill to allow that to happen? Who'd like to go first?
I'm happy to come in.
Yes, if you don't mind, Donald, your mic's on.
Yes, it's my mic's already on. Yeah, I think what the bill is aspiring to do in terms of Borna Gaelic particularly, and the coordination of the responsibility for a national Gaelic plan coming to Scottish Government, and the Borna Gaelic having responsibility or greater enforcement ability for organisations or public bodies or private enterprises, Gaelic plans, I think would be an important strengthening or that the bill will bring. I think there is still that issue of Borna Gaelic being, and I think it's mentioned in several consultation responses about that organisation being all things to all sectors and communities, and whether there should be, I think, not 100% settled on the idea of, for instance, a language commissioner that would have a responsibility for the governance and duties upon organisations with a Gaelic plan to enforce the delivery of them. but there has to be some marriage between a Scottish Government plan, a Bord na Gaelic function, be that governance and enforcement, or potentially the role of a language commissioner.
I suppose we do now have a Deputy First Minister that's responsible for the Scottish languages, so that may assist in that. Can I bring in Joanne, please? Thank you. Joanna, sorry, apologies.
That's okay, thank you. I think I would agree with the point about there currently being some tension between the various roles of Bord na Gaelic, and that the bill seems to seek to address some of that, which is excellent to see. I think coming back to an earlier point that Donald made, I would echo about the requirement for there to be an implementation plan put in place, and I think there to be some metrics associated with that, and that dose of pragmatism that, you know, budgets are not infinite, and therefore priorities need to be identified, and those priorities might look very different in different places. So where the language is more alive in the community, the priorities may look more like the care home example that's been given. But in other places, it might look quite different. So I think the ability for different places to make their own plans and set their own metrics, but then be held accountable for delivering them with resources to back that up, is where we need to get to.
OK, thank you very much for that. I suppose, can I move now to Michelle Thompson. Thanks.
Good morning. I want to come to James first. And I, like the convener, was very heartened by your descriptor of Orkney. And that's a place I've not been yet, and I'm certainly intending to visit. We touched on this earlier, but to pick up on a specific point, I wanted to explore what's currently missing in the policy landscape at the moment for supporting Scots at Arcadian, and to what extent, therefore, the bill, what does the bill address this?
So I would say that from our perspective, what's missing is probably the formal aspect, which I referred to earlier about the protection of specific language, and I'll come back, and I'm sorry to repeat myself again, and I'll keep doing it whenever I get the opportunity, that from Orkney's perspective, and we have an international renowned Institute of Northern Studies associated with the UHI Orkney that has done huge amounts of research into this. And that's why we support the principle of the bill, because we are looking for our language to be protected and make sure that there are standards around that of expectation. Now, I've already highlighted my answer to Mr. Rennie, as you highlighted, that there is a huge amount going on in Orkney that would allow that language to thrive and sustain itself. But I also believe that what the bill starts to do, and although we've not yet seen the detail behind it, it's starting to get into the what are the expectations and what are the principles and what are the standards. And that's what I think the bill is doing that makes it slightly different to what we have at this moment in time. However, not having yet seen those standards, you know, I can't really comment on that.
And so that, just so that I'm clear, it surely must just be more than standards that you regard as currently missing in the policy landscape. I'm trying to kind of drill out the gap between what the bill might enable and what's missing at the moment, and where that gaps fall. Is there more than just standards there, or has everything else been covered?
I think there's quite a lot covered from our perspective. As we said in our response, there is quite a lot that's missing from our perspective to be able to actually tease out what it is that's the detail that's behind this. But certainly from our perspective, I think it's about the sustainability and the of the language in order to make sure that it has the protection. Now, I've spoken about the element of the linguistic significance and how, from our perspective, we probably are already there. But what it would allow other areas to do is perhaps have that protection. From our perspective, I think that having it as a formal policy is welcomed in order to provide that sustainability and protection.
Okay, I wanted to bring in Donald as well with the same question, i.e. what's currently missing from the policy landscape for supporting Scots, and how specifically will the bill address that? Thanks, Donald.
I'm afraid I would only be able to answer in perspective of Gaelic. I don't have the areas of experience to comment specifically on Scots. But in the perspective of Gaelic, I think, as I mentioned previously, there are provisions, for instance, in the 2016 Act already for establishing access to Gaelic medium education and so on. But some of the landscape is exceptionally bureaucratic and challenging to create. And I think where there's a gap in what the bill may be able to try and do there is to simplify and streamline that process for education. I think as well what the bill does and addresses a gap for us potentially in is creating a greater community focus on the language, that the language will exist beyond education, which I know is a point that's already been made many times, that existing legislation maybe focuses very heavily on educational sectors as a way of securing the future of language. But I think the bill gives potential for the greater duties and greater scope to be placed on local authorities as a whole, not just education authorities within that, and communities as a whole. And I'm not saying that the bill is, as it stands, is doing that perfectly, but I think there is a potential gap that the bill is filling there in terms of creating a greater accountability. We have some concern that potentially the bill doesn't go far enough, that there may be a potential of defining rights as opposed to duties. But I think it goes a long way to trying to address a more holistic and community-wide responsibility and duty on protecting and growing language.
Okay, thank you. Joanna, I'm not going to bring you in at the moment because I want to go back to a question to James about Orcadian. In terms of the work that you've done, James, in your communities, what does success look like and how do you measure it?
From my perspective, success is where it's just happening. It's not forced. It's success is where actually the communities are coming together, they're putting on their events, their language is being spoken naturally rather than it being an enforced or forced process. But in from our perspective, that, as Donald has highlighted there, it's also success is making sure that it's happening within our schools, that we are providing experience for all young people on Orcadian language, that they are getting the experience right through the learning process. I've highlighted the Institute of Northern Studies, so there is an opportunity for that language to be developed from early learning and childcare right through to PhD level, and that would be measured from the perspective of the impact that happens and the outcome of a team, and also looking at, as I said, the level of qualification that can be achieved. But there's also that aspect for me, is as I was highlighting to Mr. Rennie, as far as I'm concerned, the success comes from the fact that you live and breathe it. As I said, you get onto that ferry, all of these announcements are made, the street names are in that, you're hearing people talking the language, and it's just very natural. And that's what I would see a positive outcome to be.
And we've heard commentary earlier about the limited financial resources available in the bill, and staying with yourself, James, but are there ways in which this bill will be helpful in providing additional support to you, notwithstanding the lack of financial resources?
Okay, so the additional support, we heard from, I think it was the panel last week, about the work that's going on in Education Scotland. We're very aware that from a Gaelic perspective, we've got Bowdoin na Gaelic in a very structured organisation there. And having ran in my last head teacher post our Gaelic unit, I can see that the power that comes from that. Now, some of the points that were made last week about the work of Scots language organisations and Education Scotland, I think there is a need to look at that and beef that up. But I would hope that from the bill that we would start to see more prevalence within Scots language and within other languages that I keep going on about, and that there is a proper, there already is a proper, but a more detailed structure to help and support that. Can I just add that as a result of our commitment as a council to the Orkney language and to the culture and heritage, throughout the major cuts that have happened over the last 10 to 12 years, we have always funded things like music tuition, free instrumental hire, because we understood that that was part of the culture and heritage of this local authority. Now, that was obviously overtaken and supported by the decision to help and fund that. But we've also done the same with sport and physical activity, where part of the culture and heritage here has been fully funded by the council. So we have continued to support that in a very difficult landscape. But in answer to your question, I would like to see more detail and more structure supporting the development of Scots and the other languages that are in the country.
Thank you. Thank you, Kim.
Thank you. Okay, great stuff. Can we now come to Ross, please, if that's okay? Thank you.
Thanks.
I wasn't aware of that. Sorry, Liam Kerr for supplementary.
Yes, thank you, convener. James Wiley, I would like to stay on the points that my friend Michelle Thompson has raised. Your submission raises concerns that the bill uses concepts of what you call a standardised Scots, for example, in translation of the bill, as opposed to recognising variants such as Orkney Norn. Can you develop that concern for the committee's understanding, please? And particularly, what does educating in Scots mean practically for the likes of Norn or indeed Doric?
From an Orkney perspective, and when we're looking at Norn, it's got a different syntactic sentence structure, all of those kind of aspects. It's different. It's not just a word that's slightly different between different dialects. It's actually the whole construction of sentences and such like. That's what makes it different. And that's what we would argue makes it a language, which is why we would like to see in this bill special recognition given to the Northern Isles and to take into consideration both Orkney and Shetland and looking at and respecting the fact that there is a different language. So in answer to your question, it's not just about different words, it's actual sentence structure and syntactic development.
I'm very grateful. I think that's an extremely important point. And that then begs the further question that when you talked earlier about getting the detail of the bill correct, what precisely did you mean by that? And what requires to be changed in the bill to ensure that the different aspects of Norn are protected and not subsumed under a standardised category of Scots?
I would argue that it should have a completely separate category in itself, because we should be getting to the place, if what the bill is doing is recognising language in Scotland, then we should be recognising that this is a language as opposed to just a dialect, and we should be having it as a separate bill. And in addition, you know, it's the subtleties that the bill has been, as you've provided in Scots, but I would argue it should be provided in Orkney Norn as well, because if we are actually seeing that this is a bill to support the heritage of our language and to ensure that it is thriving, then we need to get it right at the outset from our own perspective, rather than just lumping it in from an Orkney Norn language, just lumping it in with Scots.
A final thought from me, to pick up on something that Michelle Thompson explored and from earlier. You mentioned in your submission that there's a risk that standardised Scots comes at the expense of Orcadian language and culture, and presumably countering that will require resource and cost. You also mentioned that the additional costs and staffing pressures haven't been considered. Do you have, from looking into this process, any idea what the financial consequences of this bill would be, as drafted, on Orkney Island Council? And in any event, do you think that Orkney Island Council, given all the support that you've already put towards Norn, is in any position to take on extra costs arising from this bill to protect Norn?
At this moment in time, Orkney Island Council is not in a position to take on any additional costs for anything. We are in a position where, like everybody else, we cannot increase spending. We have got to decrease spending. Now, obviously, that means that we have to do things differently. But if I just take the context of the archipelago in which we're working in, I have 12 islands that I have individual separate schools on that are linked by ferries. And then I have the mainland, which has 11 schools on it. So when I start to look at the logistics of, especially in our return, when we raised the concern over Gaelic, if we start providing Gaelic medium education, for example, because it's requested and promoted, I have 12 linked islands with schools on them. I cannot, and as I highlighted earlier, I ran a Gaelic medium unit, which had a huge catchment area, and we bus children into. I can't do that. I can't transport children by ferry. It's too long. So therefore, we would need to be providing that facility in all these different islands. From a Orkney Norn perspective, and it was raised last week, I think, about the continual professional development for staff. So there is costs associated with that, but we wouldn't be starting from zero, which is what we would be doing with Gaelic. We would be building on a foundation that we already have in place and has already been highlighted in this morning's feedback. We also have staff in all of our schools who are in a position where they speak Orkney Norn, they speak the language and are in a position where they are there, therefore providing a community of language speakers which help and support that. From a Gaelic perspective, we'd be starting from zero. It would be a huge cost to us.
I'm very grateful, Mr. Wiley. Thank you. Convener.
And apologies for missing you out there, Liam Kerr. It's my filing system on my desk is a bit chaotic this morning. Can I bring in Ross Greer now, please? Thanks, Ross.
Thanks, Convener. And James, if I could just stick with you and go back to Michelle Thompson's line of questioning around measuring success and what that looks like. For you, does the National Performance Framework ever come into this, the national outcomes there? Is that something that you would take into account when considering how you measure success locally, or is that not relevant? There aren't really relevant indicators for your local context, in particularly in relation to success around language and Arcadian?
Well, something we're doing at the moment, but that doesn't mean that it couldn't be picked up. And I think probably, like with all of the work that's in this bill, as it starts to come to fruition, we would need to be going back to review all of what it is that we do. I was getting ahead of myself there. Should this bill come to fruition, then we would be in a position where we need to be picking up on that. There are definitely areas that we could be looking at quantifying and the impact and such like. But I think that probably comes back to some of the points that we made in our return about our concern over the costs associated with and the resource that's associated with the suggestion of having to submit plans, suggestion of all the assessment, and even, you know, we were hearing last week about once the expectations are set out and the criteria is there, that perhaps that will also be something that's measured by HMI. So that in itself is another aspect that we need to be working on. We've got to be really careful here because we are talking about areas which have very limited resources, and we need to be careful that what we're measuring is actually going to see an impact. So from our perspective, we probably have some work to do in that, Mr. Gray.
Thanks very much. And if I could ask the same original question around measuring success to Donald and Joanna, under the current policy landscape, before we take into consideration what this bill would do, as it currently stands, are you clear on how you are supposed to be measuring success in your areas, what the metrics are, and is that something that you are then able to do? Is the data then available to you for you to be able to confidently assess whether success is happening or not?
I think if I come in there first, ultimately no. I think is the answer to that question in blunt terms. I think existing measures don't necessarily capture the nuances of Gaelic. If we're talking from an education setting, existing national measures actually struggle to capture Gaelic in a meaningful way, because particularly where there are areas of small cohorts, and also the measure sitting alongside English education, and it always being dwarfed by that. So it's very hard to capture the real changes and growth in Gaelic language use and performance in Gaelic. I mentioned something last week as well about measures, which I think is an important one in this. The measures that exist in terms of Gaelic at the moment tend to be quite basic and are very much quantity focused. Number of speakers, number of enrolments, number of people achieving a certain level, number of learners. There isn't, I would say at the moment, measures that are robust enough in terms of quality. So whilst quantity measures are really important, I think we have to look, when we're talking about standards and talking about accountability, that there are quality measures built into that as well. And that may be where there are roles for organisations such as HMI or other accountability bodies. But number and quantity measures alone do give us some information, but without context around them, they can become quite meaningless and open to subjective view, whereas I think that can be supported by having quality measures around it, about quality of experience, quality of language acquisition, and how not just the number of speakers there are or number of learners that there are, but how that is being used and how frequently and to what quality.
Thanks very much, Donald. That was really useful. What impact do you think the bill is going to have then on your ability to measure success and what success is defined as? Does the bill itself actually have any significant impact on the challenges that you've just mentioned?
I think the bill alludes to it through the establishment of standards and accountability and duty, but the bill in and of itself doesn't define how that will be done. I recognise that the bill in itself and the wording of the bill wouldn't be that specific, but I think, again, similarly to other points, this is where secondary legislation or statutory guidance around the bill will become very important and will need to be developed in consultation with stakeholders around this, because we need to know in terms of how the duties and requirements of the bill are going to be measured, what these standards exactly are going to be, and how they are going to be measured over time, and how that data is then going to be used to enforce accountability or possibly negative consequence. So I think the bill gets into that space and recognises that something has to happen, but there isn't the granular detail yet as to what that would actually mean in real terms for education authorities or for a wider local authority.
Spare information.
Yeah, okay. I'll bring James and Joanna in a second. Just one final point on that. Donald, one of the challenges for us across a whole range of legislation is the balance between what we end up putting in primary legislation to give that kind of definitive clarity versus what we want in secondary legislation, statutory guidance to allow for flexibility of approach, particularly localised approach. Is there anything that you think could be on the face of this bill in primary legislation to provide more clarity but isn't? Or ultimately, is it, as you were just indicating, that's really something that should be left to the more flexible approach that secondary legislation would give us?
Yeah, I think it is that I don't think there are aspects of the face of the bill missing, but I think it's where we get into the space of what will be in that secondary legislation or statutory guidance that will allow that definition. And I think much more consultation has to happen around that. And I think there's a golden thread running through all of this about the diversity of the nation in terms of the context of this bill, which might be different to other, maybe not all other legislation, but quite a lot of other legislation which may be more applicable Scotland-wide. There are real unique geographical elements to the different aspects of this bill in lots of different ways, and having more detail on the face of the bill will make that more challenging, I think. So having just recognising that it needs to be in the secondary legislation or the statutory guidance is important enough for me. I don't think there's anything that would be adding to the face of the bill to make that clearer because of the constraints that would create.
Thanks very much. Bringing James, and then last word to Joanna.
The key points have been made, but But when I look at a measure and an outcome of success, when you do look at what we've said in a return, that in the 2011 census, 41% of Arcadians reported in that census that they spoke the language, it to me is a significant measure. Now, a lot of that was achieved through Professor Donna Heddle, who's an outstanding academic in the field of promoting it. She tried her best to get a box on the census for Orkney Norm, but that didn't happen. But I would see that as a significant measure. Do people believe that they speak the language?
Thanks very much. And Joanna, same kind of package of questions to you. So in the Highlands and Islands Enterprise context, are you clear on how you should be measuring success here as it currently stands? And is the bill going to change anything about how you measure success?
Thank you. So from a Highlands and Islands Enterprise perspective, we do already capture, as part of our organisational metrics, the support that we put into Gaelic projects and Gaelic organisations. We don't do that currently for Scots and other Scottish languages, but I think that's something that would be quite straightforward for us to do in the future. In terms of what success looks like for us, I come back to earlier points about thriving communities. It is about population. That's about the number of businesses and third sector organisations that are operating in communities, employing people, creating jobs that make use of language, whether that be something that is explicit or implicit to the roles created. I think in terms of what are appropriate measures of success, again, I'll come back to previous comments about the fact that each community is going to look quite different and the priorities in each community are going to be very different. So I think it's critical that in the future, any measures of success are determined as part of that community planning piece of work. So as communities are consulted and decide upon the right way forward for that place, then the measures of success need to go alongside what that community has set as its priorities.
Thanks very much. And in terms of the bill, are there any provisions in the bill as it currently stands that would change how HIE measures success?
Not as it stands, I don't think.
Thanks very much.
Ross, and the last sort of question is around what your view might be on the financial memorandum. We are in receipt of a letter from the Finance and Public Administration Committee on the 13th of May, when they wrote to the Cabinet Secretary raising a number of concerns associated with the measures proposed in the bill, as well as funding the support of Gaelic and Scots more generally, and they've asked that the Scottish Government reflects on the issues raised in evidence and the adequacy of the funding. So I'm wondering what your thoughts are, particularly that the bill will constitute, and I think the language is, a shift in activity, a repurposing of resources in terms of effort and attention, and not require significant additional funding. So who would like to go first on that? Can I come to you, Donald? Is that okay?
Oh, yes, absolutely. And I've touched on this a little bit in some earlier responses about concern as a local authority we have in terms of the financial memorandum. And I understand the context of how the bill could result in reprioritisation or repurposing of existing funds to ensure it aligns with the priorities of the bill. But I suppose there are two issues with that for me. Firstly, that the aspirations of the bill maybe go beyond the potential for that amount of resource. I think that there's, particularly in areas of growth and education that it aspires to, and in, for example, areas of linguistic significance that we've spoken about more today, I think that's going to require additional financial resource, particularly in resourcing plans. Secondly, in repurposing resources, these resources are already doing work in development of language, and repurposing these may come with risk, and I don't know what degree of risk assessment, as it were, has been done on what repurposing of funds could result in. For example, the funding that we may receive employs a lot of staff in the development of Gaelic medium education and supporting Gaelic language, and repurposing of these funds could disrupt that quite significantly and potentially. Another thing that I spoke about at the committee last week as well was that both local authorities in general and in the realm of Gaelic and Gaelic language, we are operating on ultimately one-year budgets and one-year grant allocations, and it's very difficult to plan strategically when your funding is being determined only year on year. Within the reality of that, it's almost within 10, 11 months, and it's very difficult with the aspirations of the bill to really plan strategically for the security and development of language to be operating with these tight financial restrictions. So I'm not sure that answers your question in full, but it's into that area.
I think throughout the session this morning, Donald, you've actually spoken quite at length, as you said, around some of the, I think, meaningful, to do something meaningful with the bill will require some significant resource. You have made reference to that throughout your evidence, so thank you for that. Can I bring in Joanna, please? Thank you.
Thank you. So a couple of points to make on this. Yes, I agree. I think that to make meaningful progress, additional resource will be required, because otherwise the progress will be too slow. What I would highlight is that from a Highlands and Islands Enterprise perspective, the way we already operate in, and again, I'm particularly focusing on Gaelic speaking areas because that's what I'm familiar with. We already have what we refer to as our target areas, and the target areas are the places that generally have a kind of multiplicity of challenges facing them, so rurality, population, etc. And there's a very strong overlap between these particularly challenged areas with places that could potentially become areas of linguistic significance. So I would say that as an organisation, we are already targeting resource to many of these places, and probably what the bill could bring to it is greater alignment with our partners, so that we're bringing our collective weight to bear in these places.
Thank you. And can I come to James, please? Hold on a wee second, James, we're not quite hearing you.
That's me.
That's you.
Thank you. I think we've got to stop kidding ourselves that repurposing is going to achieve the outcomes that we're looking for. As Donald and as Joanna have highlighted, if we want to achieve what this bill is aiming to achieve and as you read out, then it's going to have to be funded. I've already highlighted that from our own perspective, and I'm sure it's exactly the same across the country, we are in significant challenging times, and the concept that we just repurpose in order to achieve great outcomes from this is not going to happen. It needs to be properly funded.
Thank you very much for that succinct response there. So that, I'm looking around, there's nothing else. That brings our first evidence session of the morning to a close, and I'd like to thank all our witnesses for your time today. It's been very informative. And we're going to have a suspension now for 15 minutes, so that will take us to 10:40 to allow for a change of witnesses. Thank you very much. Thank you. Okay, welcome back. And we're now going to take evidence on the Scottish Languages Bill from Bord na Gaeilge. And I'd like to welcome everyone and thank you for joining us this morning. Can I ask, can I start by asking you to introduce yourselves? That would be great. Thank you very much.
I'm Elsa MacDonald and I'm the Chief Executive of Bord na Gaeilge.
Jennifer?
Martin Bass, Mr. Jennifer McCarry, and I'm Director of Education at Bord na Gaeilge.
Martin Va, Ian McVerland, Ian McMillan, Director of Development, Bord na Gaeilge.
Thank you very much. And we're going to start by having an opening statement from yourself, Ailsa. So can I hand over to you, and apologies for that pronunciation. I'll get it right as we go on.
Absolutely. No one should worry about pronouncing my name at all. It's not a bother at all. Sé am cuitramach a haseog an Gaelic, agus fydd na cogúni a níisian an djúb bwy fôr i'r canan sy'n amri teach. Agus nid ych anas mi ar canan, ha mi cilwch ar canan na halpa. Ha bort na Gaelic a cwyd ffaltio iddo fila sio. Ha na heim a ddwrt an yn slio reach gan na Gaelic, agus cwyd ymwch gilwachar a nai molach sy'n bi na bachorga a gol a ddwrt. Gan iawn yw an lahar, e cwyd ym gyrlichyd blion ys ysal mŵr os... Lichyd blion ys ysal mŵr os dig a chorga eich o'r dyn. Chwyd edrych sŵnd yn tachartyr sgyrwyd neach gyda chi'n ym bar, gymryd bawl ond sy'n chabanet i gyfel garyg, leis yn dreistyn ysdyr son o'r chanan. Cwyd gen ha yn da ddiddyf, y brein ag sy'n tycsyn i'r chanan. Ha sy'n ymdochus gyn ddech gymal rymys o'r ymwyr sy'n rhywch eichgau, ag ha sy'n ydych yn ffiwyr ddi fi y gwbl col o ddia. Ha sy'n ymdochus gyn arig sio yn ddoi wprach o hyf y garyg, tyf ystau yn y fiotas, ag sy'n ddech bechach y gyd y garyg, ha ddech portfoliwn. Fara sy'n ein gwein canan y fi na'r ffartio ffwysglion, agos gan byd corym yr doi wprach polisi ynigio, ien o'ch sio tor gys yn canan yr niartychach. Agos han byl y sio na ffartio nwbyr gys yn canan niartychach y gyd y polisi. Bi prif element sy'n fyla y gael ysdiach arichyn i'r grif yn fwrt na galic agos bwn yn yfyn yr son flanichyn gach glwys y dyddwrt gys dian o cyndioch gyfyl y system yn sy'n y cwmwl taic dys y canan. Agus ha deisiach go dtíad na helamat sin fáil an dinmhuiile a chuide gríomh. Tá fé mar soireach i dríomhhálaach scíide can an tóiriide agus bí opair na comití rochuútramach an na bhí deanú seo. Ach bí an réchas seo ach cha bhíon réchas seo na uslaach ina céiste na háráin ag idir léisaí cóirsnach. I dhéimes modal tascaí úr agus fulaiseach gus targetin na plána náisianta úr na Gaeilge ríige. Fem mi ymra go horti an tacrig y hyfmiorach yn ymnefys y fila, ffad y fel sy'n i'r daingach yn cwtrymach y ha, model ynnefys y fi mae'r thriaf element an y sarafach as yn rhegu sio. Mae'r hwrtsyn sy'n dacrig sgrifid y ac ein. Gys o lan fwy o cholynach, fe mi taicu fi eich galig i'r ffeg yn rhywltas, le mynych o'ch corymach y ha ddeir glistnus yn rhechgal fwrt na galig. Chaniau can yn y fawl na hans y galig. Dyfwran, mi hun na mysg, hain ag o'i fea, Ae criol mo cheol i mo chwltar, mo hwolachus, agos mo fianan yr son mo hewlach, agos mo choersnach. Dy galopa, hain a thia felamad jyn chwmyn sosialta a sefyl sy'n bio. Dyr nechtri, agos bia le cwtrymach ein sy'n amlu teach. Hain a stora sosialta, economicach, agos cwltaral. Hain gan frisys gan safel. Han rechgus sio na heim edd oerd. Cha toddau gain na hwlw ffwysgol gyda hi o'n, agos ffeym yr prifach os o'r ddifi a dilygeg ddys y fodol mewn i chi mi reigarach, ach bu yna ffeym ceim awn y fi y glwys y ddyddwrt sylwyr na garyg.
Thank you very much, Yalsich. Can I move to questions now from members? And can we kick the second panel off with Pam Duncan Glancy again, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, and thank you for the information you've given us in advance and also for your opening statement. It's much appreciated. My first question is quite a broad one, which is simply, how does the panel believe the bill will support the Gaelic language in the medium and long term?
Thank you. Legislation is very important for status and status. The last legislation we had in terms of Gaelic is the 2005 Act. Which is why we're sitting here today. And things like, it's time to underpin the work that's going on there. As we say in the opening statement and in our other submissions, it isn't maybe the answer to all the challenges that Gaelic is facing at the moment, but it is a step forward in some key areas, particularly in education, bringing us in line, which is very, very important. But in a wider sense, it is that
a prioritisation of the language as a national asset as well, and an acknowledgement of its importance to the culture, the heritage and the communities in which it serves. And the communities where Gaelic is spoken, and indeed communities where it's supported, maybe not spoken strongly, it's very, very important that the law is there and it strengthens and allows. Sometimes things need a catalyst in order to move them forward and to progress in policy terms as well. And I would argue that the legislation, as it does, will do that.
Thank you. Do others want to come in on that particular question?
I think the main thing, is, as Elisette was saying, is the amendments in the legislation to bring Gaelic education fully into within the education legislation, so it's fully a part of the education performance system and structure, is a significant element. And I think clarifying that means that Gaelic isn't seen as just an added extra, that it is a fundamental part of our education system in this country. And I think that is a benefit. That then gives us the opportunity to focus development activities beyond the classroom, beyond the playground, and into communities. And it gives us more of that focus. Because I think a lot of advances have been made in Gaelic education. And I think sometimes we forget that because of the success of Gaelic education, it puts some of the developments that have gone on in communities in the shade somewhat, and all the focus is on that education. And sharing that spotlight now between Gaelic and then the communities outside of schools is a significant move forward.
And do you think the bill will do that?
It's certainly clear in terms of clarifying that Gaelic education is very much part of the education framework and the education quality framework, yes.
Okay, thank you. In the submission that you sent in, you noted that trust and engagement within the community could wane if the bill doesn't adequately engage with the challenges within the community and the trust could be eroded. Do you think the bill recognises that enough? And if not, what else could it do?
I think there's always a danger that you don't connect with your communities properly, particularly when you're creating legislation that will have an impact. And I think there is work to be done in terms of ensuring that the communities feel the impact with which the legislation could have and have an understanding as to what it is that it's seeking to achieve. There's elements of the bill which are, you know, the education element is clear what that's seeking to achieve, and we welcome that. We'll probably get on in a wee while to areas of linguistic significance, but there's a real danger there that if you don't connect properly with what the communities want, but there's also an opportunity. And there's an opportunity there to listen to communities and to create a model that is appropriate for them. There's a danger as well that when we talk about Gaelic communities, we talk about one community. It's lots of different communities. I was brought up in South Uist in the Western Isles. I now live in Lewis. You'd think they would be very similar. They're not. You know, it's a very, very different experience living in both, but they're both areas within the Western Isles, which we'd expect a designation of the area of linguistic significance. So what it means and how you implement that and how you engage in creating legislation and pulling it forward. It's very important that their voices are heard and that it's not just bodies like ourselves who are important, but we have a range of key delivery bodies who do the active work on the ground. It's important their voices are heard, and I know you've had many submissions of many people, but that there's no acknowledgement that it is important that it comes from the ground up and an understanding that they very often know better than us as to what is appropriate for the areas in which they live.
Thank you. That's much appreciated. I think we'll come on to that line of questioning shortly. So for the time being, unless anyone wanted to add to that, I'll possibly leave it there.
Okay, thank you. Ruth McGuire now, please. Thanks.
Thank you, Convener Matinva. Professor O'Gilligan described the situation in traditionally Gaelic-speaking communities as being in crisis. This morning, Donald MacLeod from Corlin and Ellen Shear spoke about the need to avert decline. Where does Bord na Gaelic sit between those two elements? Or how would you describe the situation for Gaelic?
We were just listening to the evidence session and the discussion about the use of the word crisis. There is a crisis, there is an investment crisis in Gaelic that does not match the policy aspirations which have been set out for the language. You can have great policy, but if you do not fund it in an adequate model, it will fail. You can have weak policy with money behind it, which can make a difference. In response to the bill and the financial memorandum, we set out the situation that is facing Gaelic. But simply and bluntly put, we're on the same money today as we were when we were incepted. That means that we are taking a cut every year, yet the expectations are growing as to what it is that we should be able to deliver across our communities. Even
we there, are you talking specifically about Bord na Gaelic?
Well, I reference Bord na Gaelic, yes, okay. It's Bord na Gaelic, but you could take this model and have a look across the Gaelic bodies and across Gaelic investment, and you would say that there has been. I know there's different funding streams that come in, but there's no big one that coming in that's coming to the rescue of how underfunded we actually are. We are at crisis levels now, and I don't think that is an unrealistic statement to make. £5 million, give or take, 1.25, is virtually what we were created, the model that we were created. At the time that Bord na Gaelic's inception, it was argued that £10 million would be the adequate amount of money at the time. That was cut in half. I doubt back then there was an expectation that we'd still be at that level. That money goes back into our communities to deliver at a community level the activity and the growth. And it impacts, it has a wider range. It's an economic, social, cultural driver, like I say, on many, many different occasions. And sometimes you can measure that impact, and other times you just can't quantify how important it is. Our delivery bodies have been delivering at a rate that is absolutely phenomenal. They should be congratulated for it. The work that they do and the investment that people have put into Gaelic over many years, many generations, they should be applauded for it. But we're at a point now where the issue has to be addressed. In the financial memorandum, there was a use of the word stable for our funding. Now, that's an incorrect use of that word. Stable would suggest we were on the same level of money, but that we were getting the inflationary rise along with it. We've not been getting that.
Let me just pause you for a wee second. So would you assert that if Bord na Gaelic's funding had increased, that we would have stronger Gaelic in the community, that there would be more Gaelic speakers? Is that what you're... Because my initial question is about Gaelic as a whole rather than the board specifically, although I appreciate that's, you know, where
I
you're coming
would,
from.
Yes, I okay. think we would. We have evidence demand for groups. We've just had put out for our community fund. We could only fund 39% of the applications that came in. It's quite soul-destroying when you look at who we turned down. There's a demand and a wish to take Gaelic forward in your communities, and that's there, but we're unable to provide the support that people, that the communities
need. It might
be
helpful to have a brief flavour of those sorts of things, because it sounds like you're saying that if the activity that was going on just now, if there was more of it, that things would be better. So it's not that we need to do things differently, it's that they need more money? Is that what you're
it's
saying?
It was a wide range of activities, Ian.
Yeah. I think, can I go back to the use of the word crisis in the first place? I think the use of the word crisis has been useful, and it's been helpful to focus our minds. I think we have a tendency just to make do with what we have. And again, I've been working in the public sector for more than 40 years. We've always had difficulties and challenges from, I think, the first day I started in 1980 in local government. They were not good times. They were not happy times for public funding. We've always had these challenges, but we've always made do with what we've had. So I think the use of the word crisis at that point, it stopped us in our tracks a bit and has given us the opportunity to reset where we actually do things. I think as I mentioned in the last answer, we've Gaelic education has been successful. The numbers in Gaelic education are a testament to the success of Gaelic education. Taking Gaelic education fully into the education system then allows us to focus our attention more on the communities. I think this bill and the provisions of this bill make that focus an open thing, make it something that we're making a statement that yes, we're looking after education, we're allowing education to grow, to become fully part. We're now going to focus our attention to the same extent on our communities, and we need to do that.
Okay. So Jelisic said there that the money from board goes straight into communities. I was asking for a flavour of what sort of things and how it's a wide range.
There was a list given to us, and it goes across from all very community orientated though. But I mean, I don't have the list but we can provide committee with a list.
Okay. Sorry, I've treaded on a fellow member's questioning there, so I'll just leave that there just now.
Thank you very much. Yes, so carrying on with that whole community level funding, can we move now to some questions from Willie Rennie, please?
I want to talk about the areas of linguistic significance. You'll have heard the evidence earlier on. And we got a little bit of progress, I think, on what it looks like. But what I would like to hear from you, what you think an area would look like and how it would be different. But more importantly, how would we make it happen? What are the levers that we pull, and why can't we just do that now?
Yeah, you asked the question the other week as well, coming off the ferry at Loughboisdale, and it got us all talking about, you know, what would it look like, what would it feel like, and it's very good questions, I think first and foremost it'll look different depending on which area of linguistic significance you went into, and it should be what the community determines that an area of linguistic significance looks like in their area. From my own sense of what I hope it would be is that it would be at the core of policy development, and that when you see work going on and there's policy and being implemented with a recognition in your area that Gaelic is important and that there's a sense that there's been a consideration there. That will probably be easier to implement in the Western Isles than it will be in other areas where perhaps in a community in Glasgow which might wish to be designated an area of linguistic significance. And there'll be work to be done there in terms of that. You'd want strong agencies in this area which are informed and who understand the impact and the importance of the policies that they're making on the impact on the language as well. And you'd want that to come through. You'd want to see a strength from the key delivery bodies of Boards na Gaelic and other active Gaelic agencies within that area as well. Again, easier to argue that in the Western Isles, where they're all very, very active. But if you're in an area, how do we make sure that you get a sense that you're part of that. At the crux of it all, though, is the question that I am asked the most about areas of linguistic significance, which, you know, we welcome. And actually, the debate is very helpful as well as to what that would be. And what does it mean? And and what difference will it make? And I think that if you're living in an area of linguistic significance that expects to have a designation like I do, you have to say, what would make the difference in my local area to things that, and that takes us all the way back to a funding model behind it. What will it mean if there's a designation? A designation without any sort of backing behind it could be detrimental in that sense. There has to be a sense as to that it makes a difference. On one hand, status for the language is important there as well, and acknowledgement that the language is important. But I think the communities would be expecting there to see some sort of level of different engagement on the ground, and we would welcome that.
Okay. Yeah, there's quite a lot of bureaucracy and process and plans and all that kind of stuff. Do you think? I mean, we've talked previously in other sessions about the fact that it's not, the language isn't being taken home, it's not spoken in the pub or the shop, it's spoken in the school, but not.
I would take issue with that slightly.
Do you?
As somebody, so maybe not speaking so much as for the Gaelic's chair, but somebody who lives in a Gaelic community who speaks Gaelic regularly. My last trip home to US to see my mother, I didn't speak English all weekend. Okay. And that was the thing. And the other week when I was in Stornoway doing my regular Saturday chores, which was the butcher, the baker, the co-op and things like that, I didn't speak any English either. I was at an event a few weeks ago in Stornoway where there was a young group of young adults, I'll call them. They were all aged 17 to 19 and they were amivag, they were misbehaving. A bit of banter was going on. That banter was in Gaelic. There was nobody there. Nobody was pressurising them into doing it. It wasn't school. That was their natural way of communicating with each other. If you look at various events that have been going on recently, St Peter's Hall in Dalabra was packed out a few weeks ago with an event from Tupra Dualachish, everybody speaking Gaelic. There are lots of people who converse on a daily basis in Gaelic. There are still, this is not dismissing the challenges that we face and lack of understanding, but we have to take the positive points as well. And I think that's really important.
So do you think that activity has increased or decreased in recent years?
I think that from my own perspective, it's increased in the last few years.
Is that just you, though?
No, I don't. Yeah. But I'm saying my perspective. I can only argue with those. I have children who go through Gaelic medium education. I'm part of a community. And I do bop around from community to community, and I do hear it. I think that COVID has an impact as well in terms of how people see something precious and a desire to look after it. But we're getting a bit stronger in seeing who we want to be and who we are. The communities that I'm part of are changing. We're all very lovely, but we're much stronger now at not changing to English, for instance, when people come into the room. That'd be my natural reflex if somebody joined a conversation, would be to change my language. We're getting better at not doing that, and we're teaching our young people that as well. We're teaching them to be confident and strong. Gaelic medium education is having a real effect on that. We're putting out confident speakers. Not always, some people do things, but we're taking a generation and we're telling them that it's okay to speak Gaelic and how important it is to the community and the future of the language. We don't want to weigh them down with, it's all, it'll die. But actually, think of the positives here. What does it give you to be bilingual? And not just bilingual, but bilingual in a language that belongs to your country that you can contribute to as a wider. Gaelic is a big asset to Scotland. Whether you speak it or you don't speak it, you'll feel the benefit of it. And we need to be getting that message through a lot more.
So what's actually the problem then?
Oh, there's a huge problem.
Give me some tangible things about what actually the problem is.
I think we would, we've got problems a lot. Do you want to touch on education, Jennifer?
Yeah, thanks. To come in on maybe some of the key challenges that we do hear, and perhaps that the bill can provide some potential solutions for that. Often there'll be people going through their educational journey at the moment, starting off, they're enrolling in GME, and quite often when they reach secondary or continue on into their senior phase, the options perhaps across the country can be limited. And I think that's one of the key issues is the variation across the country for the offer of Gaelic medium education. And some of the things in the bill just now talks about standards and things like that could potentially help to alleviate some of that or put us in the right direction for having a bit more of a consistent offer across the country. Some secondary schools designate Gaelic as in the fluent subject, a core subject, if you like, so that there's that guarantee that they will always have that as they go through secondary education. Some schools don't. Some children are then faced with the option of thinking, well, I want to study geography, but that's in the same column as Gaelic. So they're choosing between carrying on with that. And I think it was touched on in previous sessions by the representative from CLASS. You wouldn't expect children to choose between continuing on with English against something else, but for Gaelic medium education there can be that. Anecdotally as well, we've been made aware of occasions as well where maybe people in the school say, well, you can always come back to your Gaelic. If you drop it just now, you can pick it up, but it's immersion education. So having that continued exposure to the language is really, really important. So I guess the variation across the country in terms of the offer for GME and the challenges faced by local authorities there is one of the key
So ones. You're kind of indicating that perhaps it's the education piece that where the big weakness is rather than the community. Is that where you think?
I think there's a willingness in the communities there's definitely a demand in our communities for help and support in making sure that there's the community level engagement is there and is able to happen. But they need support and they don't have the support at the moment that they deserve.
So what does that support look like? I mean, if we're talking, this is all in the area of, you know, linguistic significance. So what actually are you talking about in terms of the practical support that people need to make sure it's spoken in the community?
I think by the end of this, you're all going to think I'm a broken record. But at the end of it all, there has to be an investment model here.
Yeah, but for what?
But for the community development work that needs to go on.
What does that mean? Sorry.
Can I come in on that? I think which is helpful. What the community needs is a voice.
Okay.
And the community needs a voice. We have a system at the moment where we've talked about Gaelic medium education. That's working. That's improving. There are more young people going through Gaelic medium education. We have a system for public bodies, where public bodies are a requirement for Gaelic language plans, and to deliver on that, we have a national Gaelic language plan. We're talking about strategy in the bill. What we don't have at the moment is a voice for the communities, because the communities actually need that voice, so that the public bodies that are providing them services and have Gaelic language plans are actually providing the services and using Gaelic in a way which the community believes it requires in terms of the services it provides.
That doesn't sound expensive, though.
Pardon?
Having a voice. That doesn't sound expensive, to have a voice. Are you not the voice?
Yeah, well, we're asking for... we've made it... We're quite clear in the memorandum, the financial memorandum, that we think we should be at least brought up to where we would be with inflation. We're not even asking where we should be, and that would be 3.5. And we can demonstrate a demand from our communities for that level of funding to go into them right now, in terms of the applications that we have and the engagement that we have with them.
OK. That's fine.
OK, do you want to... Yeah. Ruth?
Thank you, Convener. So a supplementary to some of Willie Rennie's questions there about areas of linguistic significance. Elsa, your personal reflections there, I think, were helpful for committee's understanding. And certainly I was in Skye at the weekend in the house. The family spoke nothing but Gaelic. And I think maybe an interesting question might be, in your day-to-day work and life in Lewis, where do you need to speak English?
Gosh, very few places these days for me, to be honest with you, because people will see you and they know your job and things. But where do I need to speak English on a day-to-day basis? You might occasionally have to speak English at the doctor's surgery, depending on who's there. You might have to speak to the dentist, but it's very limited. But there is a confidence issue as well with Gaelic speakers as well, and we want to exude that it's a Gaelic speaking place and that people are comfortable speaking Gaelic. But I think
so. I wonder when we look at from the perspective of, because I suppose I'm more interested at the moment from the perspective of folk who live there rather than bodies or visitors, how would they know that their language was completely supported, protected? See, if it's because you don't have to change, you know, I don't have to go anywhere and speak anything other than English. You don't even have to think about it. But for Gaelic speakers, if you have to go to a medical appointment sometimes, or, you know, whatever different thing, is that something that if you have an area of linguistic significance, there would be some sort of levers to improve that situation?
You would hope so, yes, and that Gaelic opportunities were made available. That's difficult. I'm not disputing there's lots of people who live in areas of linguistic significance who don't speak Gaelic but are supportive of Gaelic as well, and who wish the best for it. We're not always talking just about Gaelic speakers when we talk about this legislation as well, as there's a wide range of support for the language. Nationally. Yes, you would look for there to be drivers like that. You would look for your children to be able to engage in after-school activities that are not just English focused. That is a difficulty. Where can you put them after school? It's not a club, you know, an after-school club where they will be able to engage and be encouraged. The work of some of our key delivery bodies like Comhairle Gaelic and their Strathachan initiatives are central and core to that. And dare I say, with more investment, they would be able to roll that model out further across into areas of linguistic significance.
Because what the committee's trying to do is really understand and get underneath what changes are needed and what difference this bill does or doesn't make. So that's why. And if the answer is solely money, then...
It's not solely money. The education elements, I think, we've made very, very clear that we welcome it. We think that the changes to the strategy as well, that the government would hold that. I think that's integral. I think I raised in my own opening statement how important it is that Gaelic is not siloed, and it feels like it is siloed just now in the education department. You yourself asked the question, Ms Duncan Cansey, about, you know, this committee and it sitting here, and I think Gaelic transcends all the departments. It's applicable when you're talking about housing here. Housing's a major issue in areas where Gaelic is spoken, in areas which would be classed as linguistic significance. What consideration is taken for Gaelic there? And I think these are elements which are important and need to be looked at. And if you bring the strategy into the government to be doing it, I think that there would be a better chance of the considerations being dealt with right across the government. And for Bordna Gaelic's monitoring role then to be that link into the communities, I think we welcome that. Okay. I think that sort of how the status that the bill would give in terms of that is very important.
Okay. So the questions about the role of Bordna Gaelic, were they for me to pick up? I'm confused now.
We've still got to go to Liam and Pam, so if you don't, I'll come back to you. Is that all right?
Sure, of course.
Liam Kerr now, please.
Very grateful and good morning. Just a couple of things to build on the areas of linguistic significance. So you'll have seen earlier, I asked the question, given the area designation of an area of linguistic significance is a local authority choice, and we've heard how little resource there is earlier on in local authorities generally, and given that there's no additional funding coming, as you've picked up earlier, do you think that there's a risk that local authorities will not avail themselves of this new designation?
Yes, probably. Yes, there's a risk to this kind of legislation anyway when there's not a... But it's why legislation is important, to put it down, that it's not a... that it's set out in legislation and that it's something that covered in communities know that they could ask. We feel that a... If local, you know, having just local authorities able to designate is a difficult. A community should have the right to request as well that they're designated an area of local, you know, an area of linguistic significance. It's very easy to look at the Western Isles. You've already said, Conaill and Shear have said that they would wish, you know. But if you take somewhere like a community in the Highlands area, or Isle of Bute, or Glasgow, or Edinburgh, or, you know, Aberdeen, it starts to get more and more interesting the moment you move out of it as to what sort of drivers would be there to force a local authority in order to make a designation that could actually have a real impact on the language and on the community that seeks to serve.
And in the response to Ruth Maguire just there, I think you suggested that there are already areas, not capitalised, if you like, of areas of linguistic significance. And if that's right, and if we start from a place that says the bill, as drafted in the areas of linguistic significance, doesn't really mandate, you were exploring with Willie Rennie, there don't seem to be too many things that the bill demands when an area is so designated, then what does this bill give any meaningful new powers to the local authorities over what they could do already if they are in a small letters area of linguistic significance?
I don't think it does to local authorities, no. I think what it does and what it should do is to those communities as opposed to the local authorities. I think local, like Cornyn Níl an Siar, have said that they would see themselves as designated the whole of Éireann Siar as an area of linguistic significance, and that's correct. Again, like Elsach, I live within that same community. But, and so they should, because more than 50% of the population speaks Gaelic. So they should actually be consider themselves as an area of linguistic significance. I think the reality is, though, is that with the focus just being on the public body, on the local authority, we've lost sight a bit of the needs of the actual community. And I know that my friends in local government would always argue that as the politically representative local body, that they do represent the communities, and they do. but only in the areas that they are statutorily responsible for and that they will take account of.
I'm very grateful. Just to be clear then, it would be your view or the board's view that the section in the bill as drafted concerning the areas of linguistic significance is therefore lacking insofar as it places too much on the local authorities and ignores the local community. Is that a fair reflection?
Yes, I think what it is, I understand why the focus is on the local authorities, because we're talking about areas. But it is where you have a local authority with one view and then a community with a different view, how do you reconcile those two? So I think in our response, we've actually put a question about which level of government actually makes a final decision. But there has to be room within that for the community itself or the communities themselves. And I think one of the challenges that we have, say in Éireann an Siar in particular, how do you define a community? I know that in all the time I was in local government and working in local government, defining communities was a very dangerous and treacherous place to be, because guaranteed, however you defined one, you would get it wrong and you would upset somebody. But there is that's why I know that in the response from Corinne Nealon Shear, they've questioned, for example, the work that we're currently doing, working with communities to develop community-based Gaelic language plans. What we're actually doing with that is using, I suppose, the powers and the opportunities that we have just now to try and bring that focus onto communities to build the confidence. And we've actually taken the opportunity significantly in Uist, where we've built upon the work of the repopulation zone working group, which is led by Corinne Nealon Shear. So we've built on that work to enable a plan, a Gaelic plan, to be developed for the whole of Uist, which is a real departure from the way things would have always been done in the past, where we would have had a plan for South Uist, we would have had a plan for Eriski, we would have had a plan for Bimbecula, we would have had one for North Uist, and probably for Bernardy as well. So we've taken the opportunity to encourage the third sector bodies within Uist and those involved in Gaelic to come together, and it was just an opportunity that they have grasped to develop a Gaelic language plan for that wider community. So I think that's a positive step forward, and I expect that will provide us with strong evidence as to maybe some of the detail that we should be taking at maybe at future stages of this bill as it progresses through Parliament.
I'm grateful. Convener.
Thank you very much, Liam Kerr. Can I come now to Pam Duncan Clancy, please? Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. And continuing this discussion a little bit further, my question is, what do you think would be specifically required? So, and ideally, if you could indicate whether that would be in legislation or whether that you already have the powers and the space to do this, for a place-based, community-led approach to supporting Gaelic that would include the public services, the third sector and the private sector in the way that I heard Ella said earlier on was important.
I don't think it's something that exists at the moment, because I know public finances are constrained. And I know that public bodies will only do what they are required to do. So if we progress, the danger in progressing any of this is about balancing the raising of expectations, which we have to do. We have to raise the confidence of communities in terms of what they're doing with Gaelic, at the same time as balancing the realities of what the public bodies will do in response. I think Gaelic language plans, for example, I think Gaelic language plans have been at a level which is fairly consistent across the country. But the expectation that people have of Gaelic language plans in places like Éireann an Siar, in parts of the Highlands, in parts of Argyll and Bute, is that they should be doing a lot more in Gaelic and for Gaelic, and that they should be more focused. Our Gaelic language plans from communities is a way of helping us to join up our public services in response to Gaelic in those communities. We have, you know, if you look at Gaelic and community, again, take the health service in the Hebrides. If you go to Hospital East in Svarai, you will hear Gaelic spoken quite regularly. The interesting thing is that the health board don't boast about that, don't take the credit for that, and they should be taking the credit for it. And they don't feel they want to take the credit for it because they're probably a bit wary about the fact that will they be able to sustain that into the next generation, into future generations. The reality is they're only going to sustain that if they take credit for how good a job they're doing over just now, and if they set out to sustain it. So the only way to actually do that is to make sure that your community has that voice. It's not to hold them to account as much as to say, well, you're doing it just now. So this is the level of activity that we actually want to maintain.
Could I just press you on that particular point? The bill team said that some of those issues would be addressed in the strategy, and the Highlands and Islands Enterprise have said that some of these issues should be on the bill. What do you think?
I think finding the balance between what you should have in primary legislation and then what you do in regulation or in the components of that is always, I would say, I mean, I don't need to tell you that as to how difficult that is to get the right balance. The way I look at this is the primary legislation is opening the door to the possibilities. The details of what I then have to do in terms of putting one foot in front of the other to walk through that door is not something that needs to be in primary legislation. It's like some of the discussions we've had about standards and about the detail that actually goes behind the bill. So what we need at this level in the primary legislation is the means by which we consult all parties who will be affected by the whether it's regulations, whether it's standards. And we need just to find a way at the moment to open the door through this primary legislation.
Thank you.
Okay. I'm just wondering if anyone else wants to comment on those questions. Are we okay? Super. And yes, can we come now to Ruth Maguire? It's back to you.
Thank you, Convener. So a couple of questions about the role of Bosna Gaelic now. And first of all, I want to ask your view on some comments that the committee received. These are not my words, but I will quote them. A small, underfunded public body that has little status or power in Scotland's wider public realm. Do you think the bill sufficiently appropriately strengthens the board's position?
Yeah, I think I'd take slight issue with some of the comments that were made there. Speaking on behalf of an organisation that I came into 7 months ago, what a committed team they are.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody who works in Gaelic does so with an element of personal. It is a labour of love on occasions that many of us who work in public service understand there. We're underfunded though, so I'm not going to take issue with that. That would surprise anybody there. And we are small. We're 18 full-time equivalent posts at the moment. So that, you know, when you're looking at the work and perhaps the expectations that are on for Bosna Gaelic, and I don't mean actually from yourselves and the Scottish Government who we work closely with, but I actually mean from our communities and the expectations that they have on what we can deliver. You can feel the weight at times, and I think it's important that and I think the bill does go some way to try and address some of these matters. I think that the slight changes in terms of taking the moving forward beyond a national plan into the national strategy, and I hope it is called a national strategy, hey, we make the point in our submission how important it is that this is a national thing. And as I say, I've made the point as well that even if you don't speak Gaelic, you're benefiting from the outputs that we have. And I think we would say that is in terms of the functions of Bord na Gaelic. We understand the changes to a role there, and we would be monitoring, and that's very welcome. It's also welcome the approach that we would report to the Parliament, and I think that is lacking just now, and that is a strengthening of the accountability for Gaelic across the nation, and it's important that the Parliament takes its role in ensuring that we're all held to account for the work that we're doing. So yes, we welcome these elements of it. There's areas where we think, you know, and I'll go back to my favourite topic, which is the investment model needs to match that, and we make it clear in our submission that we have reservations about the ability to make the changes and under the current funding that would have to be discussions and movement in there, but in principle, yes.
Grateful for those responses. Would you recognise, has there been a tension between that sort of supportive development work that the board does and holding public bodies to account?
Yeah, can I pick up on that? I think a comment that struck me that was made previously at committee as well, and it did resonate, was, you know, the comparison to Bord na Gaelic being the social worker and police officer at the same time. And I think that certainly comes into play with our work with public bodies or organisations with the language plans. You know, our officers work with them to develop these plans, but also there's the expectation that we then, you know, can monitor the progress on that as well. And I think especially in terms of education, we can perhaps give hopes or desires, for example, to see increases in the number of people learning Gaelic as a subject in school. And that's something that, of course, we can promote and we can encourage. And it's in, you know, it's in statutory guidance for education, which currently sits with ourselves, that local authorities have that duty to promote and support. But at the end of the day, we can't compel local authorities to do that. They can deliver whatever language they like as part of their 1+2 offer, even though we would like it to be Gaelic as one of them. So it's that balance, I think, of managing expectations as well. And quite often we can maybe get people coming to our members of staff as well. And I think asking questions about, well, this is happening in my local authority, and, you know, what can you do about it? Or what, this is what's happening in this school, could this happen? And that ultimately, we want to be helpful, and we are helpful, but we have to then go back and say, well, it is with the local authority that's delivering education, although it's Gaelic. So it's sometimes you can be caught between
ever, because as well as being a tension, I suppose there's also an opportunity there. If you're having relationships to build things, it doesn't have to be power or getting stuff done isn't always about just compelling people to do things.
Is I know, I agree, and you never want, you know, having, you know, language plans. It's not supposed to be, I guess, an instrument. We're not you're not the language police. You don't want people to do this just because it's something that, oh, we've got a language plan, so we have to do this. And I think over the years we've definitely seen more organisations doing things because they recognise that Gaelic is important to their area, to their organisation, and because it feels like the right thing to do, and they recognise that they have speakers in their areas that do it, rather than just being, well, we have to do this. But
it's also showcasing the opportunities as well, and it's interesting when you're in when you see an area come on a journey. Now many do it, and I know there's criticism of the plans and question marks as to how effective they are, but many of these organisations have come on a journey and they're on their second or third or fourth iteration of their plan. And if you were to talk to the team who dealt with them at the beginning of the first one, the difference in the journey they've taken. And perhaps a good example of that is a Renfrewshire Council, when they first bid to host the Royal National Mod, there was very limited engagement with Gaelic in that local authority area at the time. And they put an awful lot of work in. After that, the legacy there has been their engagement. And 10 years later, the mod came back, and what a different place it was. I should declare an interest. I was working there at the time for the first one. What a difference in terms of the acknowledgement, but not in terms of just the people who'd learned it or who were engaged with it as well, but just the acceptance of it within the local authority area. And when speaking to an ex-colleague, it was how important their plan was in the development and the journey on which they'd taken. And so you do have to, the opportunities are definitely there, you get more from a carrot than a stick on many, many occasions. And with Gaelic, I think that's the way we would prefer to work. It's a positive thing. It's a great thing, in fact. You're very lucky if you have it, and everyone else should want to have it in their area and want the benefits that it brings. And that's how you should showcase it. And I think that's the work that we try to do with our plans.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for that. I suppose sticking on that sort of theme, and you were talking earlier about how you only have 18 full-time posts, as you're a small organisation. So does the board currently have the capacity to monitor progress for the Gaelic language across all of Scotland? And is it sufficiently, this might be one, are you sufficiently independent enough to hold the Scottish Government to account for progress in this area should the legislation...
The answer to that is yes. About independent enough to hold the Scottish Government to account. Yes, we are. I think what in terms of resource, if we had more resource, we could do more. We could do things quicker.
But we know the resource from the FM isn't going to be coming. So we might, in the context of the bill, then I suppose. Yep. Do you have the capacity to monitor progress?
I think what I would say in terms of the bill, what I see as being particularly useful in terms of plans and holding organisations to account, if you like, is the link between the Gaelic language strategy, the standards, and the Gaelic language plans. That I can see that if we get standards right, if we actually have clear standards that can be applied to Gaelic language planning in public organisations, then that would take a lot of the negotiation that we have with each individual public body on each individual iteration of their plan about what their plan should include. If what we have at the moment, we have corporate service aims, which we literally have to go and negotiate with every single public body in every iteration of their plan to include what are fairly standard corporate service aims into their plans. If those corporate service aims were included within standards as secondary legislation to this bill, we wouldn't have to go and negotiate that all the time. That would be a given. We would spend less time, or have to spend less time, developing the plans, and could spend more time in making sure that plans were implemented. Again, in terms of that, it's interesting that Jennifer referred to this mix of social worker and police officer. Well, we're not there just to police. We're there to work in partnership with. We talk a lot about working in partnership in the public sector. So we should be spending more time in making sure that plans are achievable, that they genuinely do have smart targets in them that are achievable, not just measurable, that we can actually see whether there has been progress. And I think plans are not, language plans are not the only answer to developing Gaelic, but they're a part of the framework, and they're an important part of the framework in an environment where public bodies will do what public bodies are required to do. And that's becoming more and more the case.
So are you saying there, Ian, that the public bodies, Gaelic, the language plans from the public bodies should remain part of that policy landscape then alongside all the proposed national strategies, yes, the guidance and the standards?
Yeah, I see all of these working in together in this, and I think that's what the bill is looking to achieve, to knit these together so that they work together more effectively.
And just so with that in mind, how effective are the public bodies' Gaelic language plans been in supporting the long term as they are now and widespread use of Gaelic? How effective have these been?
I think safe to say that they have been a significant part of the progress that's been made. I would imagine that any of us looking at individual plans, individual authorities would say, but yes, we could be doing more.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe we could be doing more, we could be doing it quicker. But again, in the context of resources available, in terms of all the different priorities yeah. that individual organisations have, that government has, that even that Bord na Gaeilge has, the prioritisation of activities with a view to achieving an outcome is a big, big challenge for all of us.
Yeah. Does anyone else want to come in on that before him?
No, just to add to that as well, I think we can see in areas where they maybe wouldn't be described as a traditional area or areas with high numbers of speakers, the difference that a plan can make, even with some of the workforce and say it's a local authority or the setting up of community groups or, you know, pockets of areas where they maybe have GME or Gaelic learners activities, you can see that that's without having the plan there that perhaps these things maybe wouldn't have had the impetus to get up and running off the ground. So I think that they have made a difference.
Mm-hmm.
And clear standards will assist in that. It will okay. it will take it forward, and there will remove that sense that, you know, so and so's plan's different to my. Why am I being asked to do this? And the acknowledgement there that there's standards that everybody has to meet, and then you can, you know, there's your own local areas and your own priorities will come into that. And I think it's very important. I would just like to go back, if that's okay, convener, to the point you made about whether we're independent enough. I mean,
yes, yeah, I think super,
it's,
thanks.
I think it's very clear we are. I think that we work very well with our Scottish Government colleagues on holding each other to account. We have robust discussions regularly, and we're consistently challenging one another. But we all are working for the same aims in the most part. Maybe perhaps we've got different ideas on how we can reach the definitions, but we're exceptionally independent.
Have you got an example of where you're... sheer resilience and independence, and that has provided a
well. Since
success.
I came, I'm new in post, yeah. It's not been quiet. It's got to be said since I took post, but we've had a number of discussion areas, and we had to engage with them very closely in terms of the Gaelic Development Officer scheme, which came under threat as a removal of top up funding there. And the easy thing for us to have done there would have just to say, right, the funding is gone. But we've been challenging, and they've been challenging us as well. And I think it's very important that it's recognised and the challenge on both sides.
Thank you very much for that. And can I now move to Bill Kidd, please? Thanks, Bill.
And thank you, convener. Thank you very much, everyone. And lessons from the experience of Gaelic development, which I suppose you're all the best people to really talk about. This since 2006, in particular, around about that time, 2005, 2006. The lessons of the experiences that have been used in developing Gaelic across the country, and in particular in those areas where it's particularly strong, how can those lessons be used to help to guarantee future development of Gaelic, and maybe even Scots as well, actually, as to take an, so we can take an example for the Scots language as well. But how, in particular, can you see lessons that will be used by yourselves going forward? Because, I mean, you must have found that certain things work better than others, actually, you know, and what do you use in particular to get people interested and maintain the development?
I think I'd take the focus back to communities again. I think that's the engagement with the communities, ensuring that they're at the heart of everything that you do, and that they feel that they're at the heart of everything they do. Not just that we think they're at the heart. A different answer there, but the communities have to be part of it, and their experience and their lived experience has to be taken into account. And as we, you know, we change things and we wonder, but as we move forward, that they have to be at the core of everything, and that they feel they're at the core. And as this committee moves forward, with the work that you have to do on this bill, I think it's important that you hear these community voices and that you experience these community voices. I mean, I would recommend personally that you go to a community and you discuss it with them. But you know, I imagine you want to bring people in. But I think that that's maybe what's missing from this first stage one of the bill at the moment is the direct community voices. We have key delivery bodies, a number of them from Comyn na Gaelic to Féin Sin Gael to Nkomo na Gael. You'll be familiar with all these names, so you'll be hearing them as part of this. But a lot of you will be familiar with them in terms of activities and things going on in your own constituencies. They will inform you as to the importance of being connected to the people that actually are going to speak this language and to take it forward and to be community drivers as well. And I think that that's the experiences that we have to take. There's other experience we have to take forward on a policy level as well. As I doubt anybody who was involved in the drafting of the 2005 Act expected it to be 20 years before legislation came in front of us as well. And we have to, we have to learn from these things in terms of how the policy machine and the legislative machine works and how we engage across. And perhaps our models that we work just now, I think we would, I think we're definitely developing much more integrated approaches to policy and partnership. On the previous question, we were acknowledging that how small Bord na Gaelic is, but we're mighty on occasions because of the partnerships that we have and the work that we do with others. Our work is valued and how we engage with people is valued as well. And we think that that is a key element of taking things forward as well.
Correct. I think one of the important things is that we cannot always do all things holistically across the piece all at the same time is one thing. And the other thing is we've got to be prepared for success. We've actually got, I don't think that across the country we were as prepared for the success of Gaelic medium education as we could have been, as we might have been, and that we need to be ready that for the plans that we have, that actually they might work, that they might do that. I think if you look at the numbers of pupils going through Gaelic medium education, I would imagine they are significantly higher than, I'm not sure if they are, of what some people would have expected, but I'm not sure of what the view was here in Parliament at the time as to what the numbers might be. But the thing is, that success then brings a demand for more activity, for more services to support that success, to make sure that we are taking full advantage of the things that we've actually done well. And I think some of it too is having that longer term view of what we can achieve. I think we have a serious challenge in that we still manage our finances on a year by year basis. That's not helpful. We have been working at changing that with our key delivery bodies and with some of our schemes to look towards a 5-year horizon where we are actually planning more strategically so that we can see a wider benefit. That's something that we need to look at. Even from our point of view in terms of strategy, and I think maybe that's the thing, we're still looking at it here, we're still talking 5 years. I'm sorry, for language protection, language development, we should be looking 20 years. And I know that's difficult, and that's difficult in terms of the electoral cycles and everything else that we have to work with. But if we need to have strategies that are 5-year strategies, that's fine. I think they should still sit within a wider framework that takes us much further forward and that is confident enough to say, by the way, what do we do when this works or when elements of this work? And I don't think we're always prepared for success as we should be. And I think that is something, and it is step by step, but it's identifying which step do you take first.
Just to add to your comment about lessons from 2005 onwards, and none of us were we were working at Borsen Gaelic at that time, but I think having been involved and seeing things that I think in the past there's probably been a focus on quantity and numerical targets, and I think now is a real time to be looking at that quality as well. I mean, going back to education as well, there is with the potential for statutory guidance to be sitting with at ministerial level rather than with public body. I think there's a real challenge, a real opportunity here to have, you know, the able to measure quality and across the educational organisations here, and, you know, not just having people going through GME and having that measured by, you know, numbers enrolling in that, but what is the experience that they're getting through their educational journey from early years through to secondary and indeed beyond into further education, should that be the case.
It's really helpful because it shows from what all three of you have said that you are aware of what you've been doing over time, maybe not just yourselves but the organisations, and the success that's had, and working out from that where you go next. But the most important thing, I think, that what you've really said is it's not really based around talking at people and communities, it's talking with them and bringing them together, and it's really useful. Thank you.
Lots of nodding heads from the board there. Can I bring in some questions now from Ross Greer, please? Thank you.
Thanks.
Oh, sorry, apologies, I've done it again. This is twice today. I have forgotten Liam Kerr. Oh, I'm going to be in trouble later. Liam Kerr, please, apologies.
It's been noted. I just have a very brief question, actually. Just based on what Bill Kidd was going on, the 2005 Act set up the board and gave the board responsibility for promoting Gaelic. And it's clear, it seems to me, that the board has done that with a great deal of passion and commitment. However, 20 years on from that, the situation was described earlier as a crisis, as the policy hasn't been matched by funding and perhaps government support. Now, in relation to Scots, the Scots doesn't even get a board. What do you think will be the impact of that if establishing a Gaelic board still leads to a crisis 20 years on?
I'd be reluctant to provide a prescription for Scots in terms of the, because people who speak Scots and who are involved in that know best what is right for their language and things like, which theirs as well. But as I'm not well versed enough in terms of the things. But what you would say is that status and acknowledgement of the language is very, very important. And then a clear pathway on the way forward, I think, would be what they would want to seek. And I'd hate to put words in anyone's mouth. You know, we're born in Gaelic and we focus on the work of Gaelic in Gaelic-speaking areas. But for our Scots colleagues, I think that they're on a different, they're on a journey. It's an important, very important journey, but they shouldn't. It's not the case that what works for Gaelic will work for Scots, and vice versa. And I think that they should, that they'll have their own areas which they seek to focus on. For Gaelic at the time, Gaelic medium education was very much a priority. And rightly so, in my opinion. But we see the benefits of that today. Whether that's the exact model, but they should, you know, we will engage with our Scots colleagues at any point if they'd wish to.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Now we can move to questions from Ross Greer.
Thank you, Convener. One of the challenges that we've got at the moment and we've historically had is the lack of a national framework for measuring success in relation to Gaelic. We have the government's Gaelic language plan, there's the plans and strategies that the board has produced as well. But beyond plans, we don't have anything that's clear about national agreement on a framework for actually measuring the success in relation to that. So if you look at the government's Gaelic language plan, it references the national performance framework, not because there are clear indicators there, but just in relation to what the interaction is between Gaelic and a whole range of other indicators, housing, communities, etc. What do you think has been the barrier? Why are we not sitting here now with a clear, nationally agreed framework for how we measure success in relation to the Gaelic language?
I'm not so sure that's an easy question to answer, and it's not supposed to be. I can understand. I would maybe suggest that one of the challenges that we have in Gaelic, and actually looking at the success of Gaelic, is linked directly to the strength and the success of the Gaelic communities themselves. And I think that the big opportunity that we have with what's in the bill is the government taking ownership of the strategy. And with the government taking ownership of the strategy, there should be a better opportunity for government to link up all the attributes of government to make sure that whether it's in, you know, we talk about housing and jobs and a whole raft of economic drivers in communities. Port na Gaelic can't influence those. We, you know, there has been a wrong perception that somehow because it's Gaelic, we have to look to Port na Gaelic, we have to look to additional funding, we have to look to something extra coming in from the side. But actually, in Gaelic communities, Gaelic is just very much part of the community. You know, as Ellis had said in her, in what she said at the beginning, you know, Gaelic is very much part of who we are. It's very, very difficult to define the impact of Gaelic and who we are and our lives. You know, Gaelic was my first language. I had to learn English when I went to school, and I'm of an age where we didn't have television at the time, so it was probably a lot easier not to be corrupted by English at an early age. And that is, in effect, what it is. It is a corruption of our culture and our language and our heritage. But being bilingual is a huge benefit, and I'm thankful for who I am, where I'm from, and the privileges that I've had because of the two languages that I speak naturally. Whether I speak them well or not is a matter of opinion. But I think there is an opportunity for government to join all this up if government is taking ownership of the strategy. And that is something that, however well-intentioned we might be in leading the development of a National Gaelic Language Plan, and despite the fact that, yes, ministers can change it and do finally approve it, that's not the same as taking ownership of the strategy. But I think I would go back, it does have to be longer term. And there is, maybe the thing is as well, maybe it takes away some of the excuses, that there are fewer excuses if it's clear who's taking ownership. And it's easier then to be held to account, because it's, How do we make government in the widest sense work better so that all the individual parts of government actually work together to create the right environment so that we can see success?
I think that is a really important point around ownership and a clear sense of ownership and accountability being a way to improve outcomes. But my question, or next question then, is about whether you think the bill actually makes it clear how we measure that. This is going to give government much more accountability. Hopefully, it will put more scrutiny on government. But certainly from our perspective, but from wider societal perspective, the question is, well, what are we scrutinising the government for? How do we collectively as a society, how does government itself judge whether it has been successful or not? And what I'm really looking for is your perspective on whether the bill itself makes that clear, whether you look at the bill and think, it will be clear to me 5-10 years from now how we measure success based on what is in here, or could there be something else either in the bill or external to the bill that makes it much clearer how we are going to measure success here?
I think the strategy should make it clear how we measure success, but I think what needs to be in the bill is that requirement that the strategy has to do that. And I think that's what we need to be explicit about in the primary legislation, to make sure that the secondary steps actually do come back with the answer, because we do need to be clear about what it is that we're trying to achieve. And I think that in itself, what we're actually trying to achieve will determine the timescale in which we should be doing things as well. And I still think there is a question in that as well about the setting of that strategy, and you're looking at the outcomes. Realistically, is there any point in having a strategy for 5 years if you can't measure the outcomes for 10?
Thanks very much. Anybody else got a perspective on that, about kind of what a framework for success looks like? And
I think it's
it
a very important question. I think that the current model that we have just now with a national plan, and Portna Gaelic obviously report on an annual basis through an annual report on our own KPIs and how we're dealing against our corporate plan. And that is very important, but I think there are wider issues against the strategy that would require to be looked at and should be measured. And I think a measurement framework is a key element that should be looked at taking it forward. It's all very well, you know, working through all the time, but reporting back on progress is important, and that data and that information will be crucial as we look to the long term for the 20 years ahead of us.
And where should that sit in relation to the building? So obviously, if we can't be incredibly prescriptive in primary legislation with what our measures of success are going to be, because we don't know where we'll be in 20 years' time on all sorts of fronts. But the bill's obviously an opportunity for us to create some requirements in that space.
I think that is the area of the strategy that it should be, to see that the strategy, that this is part that the strategy will determine, that there should be a measurable framework and look at it beyond in the secondary legislation. But I think it is important that it's in there and it's referenced.
Ruth.
Thank you. Just sort of on that theme in terms of outcomes, I suppose I'm sometimes struck when we're listening, we all in this place talk in almost like a different language some of the time, with performance frameworks and all these types of things. Is this maybe an area where we should be hearing from communities what success would look like? I was struck by, Ian, you said there, you know, it's just part of me, I just speak Gaelic, but we maybe need to know from folk, what are blockers? Where do you come up against things? Where does it grate? Where do you feel you're not, you know, being able to use your language fully, or it's not being given respect? And I know those things aren't always as easy to measure if we just ask people in normal language, but it might be something valuable to do.
I think it is valuable, and I think the voice of communities is essential. You know, you'll sit here and we're talking about frameworks and national plans and corporate strategies and all the rest of it, and that's really, really important. And we shouldn't lose sight, but I think that there is a disconnect sometimes with how the communities look at what we're doing and the importance and the importance they place in it. Now, we understand we're producing the foundations in policy and law. So one group in tweeted last week that this bill is as far away from them as John O'Groats. There's a Gaelic saying. I'm not sure why there is a Gaelic saying about John O'Groats, but there is about being, it means that you're miles away from them. And I have sympathy with that, I really do, and I think it's important. That's why I'm recommending that you go and speak to them. But if you spoke to young Gaelic, and I'll say women here, but families in the Western Isles, I'll talk about childcare being one of the biggest barriers at the moment that they're facing in multiple levels. And you think straight away from an economic level, but actually from a language level as well, and being able to put their children into a childcare that will be able to allow them to carry on. These are the discussion points that the community will raise up. And I think it's vitally important that the voice of the communities is heard. And again, heard directly, not necessarily just through bodies like ourselves. We'll raise points, and we all have lived experience of Gaelic, and I'm sure that's beneficial. But it is exceptionally important, I think, that you hear it from the communities.
Thank you.
Do you want to add to that?
Just to come in that, talking about being a voice, and part of our work has been over the last few years, as you'll know, there are a huge amount of consultations or calls for evidence or, you know, feedback to Parliament, and we'll always reply and raise the question. Pretty much what we do day in, day out a lot of times, think, what about Gaelic? What's the impact on Gaelic? Where does Gaelic feature in this policy? That should be part of everything from the outset. And while we respond to this, there's also an element of encouraging other groups and other people and, you know, someone sitting in their house on their own, they can respond to these things and make their voices heard too. So while we will act as that, you know, we can give a response asking key questions about where Gaelic maybe features in any policy decision, I think it is still important that there's a chance for people to make their voices heard as well. And I think we do find that even in the amount of responses to the consultation for this bill and for others, that we see a lot more people feeling that they do want to engage and get their opinions put across.
Fielsa?
Just a very small point, yeah. Is that sometimes you have to ask them as well. You can't expect, I mean, I can't, you know, these consultations and things, particularly this one, was a tough read and a tough go through. And, you know, if you want to hear, you have to go and ask them for their answer, what the issues that they're facing, and particularly in communities who feel as if they might feel quite far away from where we're sitting today.
Yes, I suspect, you know, people do have lives outside Scottish Parliament and legislation, and making them aware of what's going on. I know, is that not a surprise to all of us? and getting them tuned in to things is key. Thank you very much. Can we come now to questions from Michelle Thompson, please?
Hello, good morning. Thanks for joining us. I just wanted to take a sort of sense check on the financial memorandum, and I note from your evidence, I mean, you gave some... your submission made some fairly stern commentary about what you saw, some of the issues that you cover off resource and seeking more investment and potentially diminishing trust in communities if the associated funding's not in place. I'm a bit confused with how that relates then to the actual financial memorandum itself, that really sort of sets out the fact that it's moving from one body of good practice and in the existing plans into, in essence, a kind of refocusing. So my first question is, how rigorously have you been through the financial memorandum and therefore what additional commentary would you like to bring out? And two, what discussions have you had with the Scottish Government that articulate at a detailed level your concerns that you've illustrated in your submission?
I think it's widely accepted we put in quite a strong response to the financial memorandum, and you can understand why when you read it. That point that's very important, that our money has been flat. We take issue with the word stable, but it's been flat since that, and yet the expectation of what we will deliver is high. It's not just for ourselves, you know, it's across, you know, there's other organisations, MG ALPA, who run BBC ALPA in partnership with the BBC. They have the same issue. They're on flat money since their inception as well. And that means that development in different ways and what we're able to achieve is really constrained. But we're now at a point where I think it has to be addressed, and the financial memorandum is very important to us as a vehicle to have our concerns heard outside of wider government. This is a conversation we have consistently with the Scottish Government that we are consistently explaining to them. And I'll be honest, we're asking for more money on a consistent basis, but there's always a business case against it. We want to, you know, we're not just our hand. There are real things that we can achieve in our communities if we had the investment. We welcome the additionals that we get on occasion, but none of that's ever put into our core. And our core is sitting at 500. That makes it very difficult to plan. It makes it very difficult to engage. We're moving to a longer-term funding models without key delivery bodies, but we're having to base that based on a current model that we have just now. And it's exceptionally... We will be looking as we move forward if we don't see further investment and what things we'll have to stop doing. That's a good conversation on occasion, but not when it's driven solely by a financial requirement. And that's where we are. We have robust discussions with the Scottish Government. We make it very clear to the Scottish Government what we could do and why we need the additional money. I accept the argument that public finances are constrained just now, but that hasn't been the case for the last 20 years, and we've definitely been in the poor relation, and we should have seen some investment. It is only fair and just that the funding model moves, and at least we're given the inflation, which is £3.5 million on to our current core funding for money at the moment.
Okay, so Thank you for that. And what you've given is a very general sense of how funding, long-term funding constraints have affected you. And I don't disagree. And I know from another life on the Finance Committee that for your commentary, that would be the same for a multitude of other sectors and organisations. But what I was trying to explore was the extent to which you've had active discussions with the Scottish Government in terms of the specifics contained within the financial memorandum. Because, I mean, let's assume that this bill goes through and that this refocusing is going to take place and you have existing resource and you're going to have to do that work. Have you had the discussions around what that would look like? That, and obviously the financial memorandum is suggesting that that can happen within the envelope that you already have. So have you gone down to that level of discussion with the Scottish Government?
Not in the specifics, no, that's okay. In the financial memorandum. But it is a case of that we're always, you know, and we have brought it up in discussion.
Yeah.
You know,
so your
the
commentary
plan,
is really
but
about...
But we have an ongoing discussion
okay.
on this.
Okay, that helps make it clear. So your commentary is really about the general funding envelope and the
yes.
time since... Okay.
Yes.
Okay, that's great. Thank you very much.
That's super. Thank you for that. That actually is all we have time for today, and the public part of today's meeting is now at an end. So can I thank everyone for your time this morning, and we'll now consider our final agenda items in private, so I'll suspend the meeting. Thank you. Quick 5 minutes.